Are you not entertained? Are you not entertained? Is this not why you are here?
All right, you dirty coomers. Are you guys ready? Are you ready to hold back? Are you holding back on me? Are you withholding? What are you withholding? You're grinding your teeth. Are you chewing ice? Did you crunch ice? That's what we should call this. This is the ice crunching show. I have Ryan Stone. He's on deck. We're going to talk about the soul-saving power of semen retention. Coming up on The Rational Man. Oh, yep. It's about that time, isn't it? Sorry, I couldn't be here yesterday. I had other things to take care of. Oh, but I am joined today by Ryan Stone. There's your cheering. There's your cheering. Oh, thank you. Yeah.
You taste
the official, the official candy of the Rational Mail, sponsored by. Yeah. We should actually sponsor this this show by Trojan condoms.
Tried tactical. Didn't
work out so hot. Yeah. Hang on one second. Let me fix your audio real quick.
These are actually pretty good.
There you go. Try it now. How's that? Better?
Test. 1, 2, 3. Hands off dick. Dick off hands.
Good. We're good to go.
All right.
We have not done a show together in a long time. And I apologize for bringing you in on this particular topic.
All the great things we could have discussed, the very end of conversations, we could talk about tugging it.
Philosophical, we could have got, oh gosh, we could have done so much more, but well, remember what I said, sizzle and steak, man. Sizzle. It's going to be a lot of sizzle and I don't know how much steak. So.
Can I just say at the beginning here, I keep saying this, but I'm like, screw you for making me have to research this asinine topic. All the things. I've had to read so much about rubbing out knuckle children and not one titty. Not one. Any of it.
Children. I like that. Yeah. This is funny. This is technically about snapping, you guys. Ah, no, we're going to talk about other things too. Yeah, it's such a broad topic though, like semen retention versus no fat. Like, you know, what's funny is I put this up. Let me explain to you guys why I wasn't on yesterday on my regular day. Cause it was Mama Tomasi's 81st birthday and I had to go talk to her behind a screen again. For the last 6 months, I've been doing the exact same thing, because of good old Governor Sisolak, who hopefully will be a one-term governor here. So anyways, that gave me a little bit of extra time to sort of prep and to, today is going to be full of just sexual and like jerking off innuendos. You cannot talk about masturbation without coming up with a bunch of like really bad puns. Really, really bad. Like, what do they call them? Not non sequiturs, but whatever. Innuendos, let's just say. Anyways, I am fully aware that there's a difference between NoFap and sperm retention, semen retention, whatever you'd like to call it. Well, I put it this way. I think there's a causal link. I know that correlation is not causation, but in this case, I think there might be a link. Well, we'll explore that today. One of the reasons why I wanted to sort of cover this topic is because usually right around November, and we're kind of getting to this early, but right around November is when we get the NoFap November crew. And I think really since 2018, 2019, I think probably 2017, right around November. Yes, I know it's Simp September. No Simp September, right? There you go. NoFap November. Gosh, OnlyFans October. I think that this we're in a little bit of a different place, I think, in the manosphere now because of things like OnlyFans. If you guys saw my last show I was talking about Bella Thorne with Sterling Cooper on Sunday. And I love how everybody says, well, it's not about the sex. It's about the connection. It's about everything else. Yeah, I 100% agree. That's exactly what I said. But it's also about the sex too. You wouldn't be there if there wasn't some sort of like sexual, like titillation, let's just say, to sort of.
And plus, like, define connection. Are they talking about you're getting oxytocin from the person? Are you talking about you're getting a dopamine response? Because if it's dopamine, yeah, it's about the sex. If it's about serotonin or oxytocin, it's about the companionship after sex. But you can't really remove sex from the situation. It just doesn't happen.
Yeah. So I wanted to talk about it because every time I am sort of researching tags for different things, like such as thanks for that $13.99 there, DB. When I'm looking at tags, and I'm probably like the worst thing I ever did, and also the best thing I ever did, was to get VidIQ for my I don't have like the big huge like super paid one, but I do have the VidIQ whatever the mid-range one is. I actually paid for that so I can sort of track, you know, stats and things. And tags is one of the big things. I've talked about this when I was talking about the Pro Revenge tag back in the day. And then also one of the biggest tags for whatever reason in the manosphere is semen retention. It is like one of the best tags you can put on. It's like it's a on a 10 scale, it's right around like 7 or 8, I think, right now.
Seriously.
It's a crazy good one because it's low competition and it's very high search volume. And I mean like in the millions search volume. So so that there's that. And then NoFap is a close second behind that. And I started thinking about this. I'm like, why the hell would this be like such a popular tag? And the thing is it goes beyond just the manosphere. That's why.
Oh, really?
Not just a manosphere thing. It's like a guy thing, right? I don't know. It could be a religious thing. It could be a scientific thing, which we're going to talk about a little bit today. Like you've done your research. So God forbid I wouldn't want to put that to use.
We'll save it for when it comes up. Just leave it there.
So, gosh. So we have done our homework for this one, guys. So before you think that, oh, these guys don't know the difference between NoFap and sperm retention. No, we do. We really, unfortunately, this is probably one of the most well-researched shows I've ever done. So anyways, so I wanted to sort of dig into this, but what really prompted me to it was not just so much the OnlyFans, the rise in OnlyFans popularity, but I'm seeing a lot of guys who are taking out advertising ads on my channel, because my channel is really, as you've seen, the numbers is really booming right now. But I've got like Pinnacle of a Man taking out ads specifically on my channel. I guess
he's paying bills with you too, is he?
Yeah, he's paying bills by dropping ads for his new product, which is I will teach you how to stop touching yourself in 6 easy steps, or whatever the new program is, whatever the new revenue funnel launch is for him. That's the new thing.
Well, that's a key point, because you mentioned it's actually a free course or a free sign up, and that's definitely a funnel activity, which kind of gets into a big point I've found on this. When you talk about semen retention, there is a shopping list of things that guys suggest that you do with your masculine energy now that it's bigger. They had me at cold showers in there. They promised the moon, but where is it? Yoga, lifting weights, running, cold showers, meditation, qigong, breathing. The gym, or the, was that Hof guy?
Oh, Wim Hof breathing. Oh,
Wim Hof breathing kind of makes an appearance in here. Your creativeness, playing music, nature, being more disciplined, eating healthier, laughing. It's like everything is designed to give you, that constant con artist schema where they make you invest, but it's such a little investment that it's not a big deal. Hey, could you hand me that? Yeah, sure. And then it's keep doing more and more and more of these things. And it psychologically primes you, so that when they want something back, you've invested all of these other things in there that you're actually more inclined to. So it's got a very natural grifting schema to it. Do you know what I mean?
Right. And there's a lot of guilt that's there's a lot of guilt that's associated with it. And I think right now it's more of a big deal because we're living in an age right now, and I don't want to make light too much of this today, but we're living in an age, a day and age right now where we have access to 24-hour, 7-day a week, 4K, probably soon to be 5K, streaming high def pornography that is free. It's not like, I don't know about you. Okay. How old are you, Ryan?
I'm 40.
You're 40. Okay. Mm. Well, okay. So you're probably, you lived in an age prior to the internet and prior to all of this great
stream. I remember magazines.
I remember. And people say we really want to get inside your head, Rollo. Okay. Well, here's a little bit of history. When I was about, 12, 13, 14, somewhere around there, when you're just right on the cusp of like really getting all the hormones are hitting on all, 8 cylinders. Mm-hmm. That's when you go and you search for your uncle's penthouse or a hustler or
Easy Rider.
And if you, and what we would do, and I wasn't alone in this. This is what the guy, the teenage kids of the like early to mid 80s would do, is if you got a penthouse or hustler or whatever, it was like pirate's gold, and you would take that and you would put it away somewhere where no one would ever find it, because you know that if your friends or your brothers or whatever, and I had two brothers, well, I have my natural brother and stepbrother, if they found those things, they'd disappear. And that's how guys learn about sex, is through pornography. That's how girls will learn about sex now too. Is through porn. But back in the day, there was no, there wasn't even like, remember the softcore porn channels that were on cable TV?
Channel Friday evenings, but we had an 8-foot satellite dish outside too. So I remember G4 was the satellite for the porn stations.
Mm-hmm.
And we had like the red box. So we had like broken the encryption. So we stole it. And I remember, yeah, but you had to be careful because it was one signal for the whole house. So the parents had a TV in their bedroom. So I had to make sure they were sleeping.
So you had a descrambler or something like that?
Yeah, it was a little descrambler, and every month they'd send you a little red card that you put into the descrambler box, which would descramble the signal coming in from the satellite, so you wouldn't have to pay for there was Hustler, Penthouse, Playboy, and some other one I can't remember, like Cherry or something like that. Mm-hmm. It's been a while. The 80s are a long time ago.
And even when you got those were still like softcore porn. They weren't like super, at least in my experience. I remember back in the Well, I was older then, but like I would have been like, 19, maybe 20 years old, something like that. And then you go, whoa, there's actually porn on TV. I can go and call it up and say, hey, give me whatever, the Spice Channel. That's what it was. It was a Spice Channel.
And Spice, that was the one.
It was softcore. So it wasn't any like insertion or anything. It was just like naked chicks and stuff like that.
Yeah, basically porn without the dick.
Pretty much, yeah. And even when you got magazines, if you got Penthouse or Playboy or Hustler, it still was softcore. There was just chicks in it. Or maybe in like Penthouse, there was like some like pictorials, but it was not anything remotely like the average like 10-year-old kid today can get a hold of. So I wanted to make sure that like people realize, because a lot of people, I mean, this is the last two generations, and I think the boomer generation, the Gen X and maybe Gen Y lived prior to the internet. But like this next generation, who I think really is being targeted for this NoFap stuff, they don't know anything about that. They never had to actually, I mean, even when you like were decrypting or uncrypting, like, you turn into like this mad scientist just to like figure out how can I get this?
Yeah. You know? Adobe Hackers was based on my life.
Mm-hmm. It was like, or like if you knew your friends had like a Hustler or something like that, and it was a more recent issue than yours or something, you would be like, it was like espionage. It was like international espionage trying to figure out, okay, he's going to be gone at school at this time. I'm going to slip into his house and I'll go grab it. I don't know where it is, but I'll find it,
Yeah, or you'd just be chilling in like his bedroom and you'd like leaf through it if you knew he could trust you with it. And you guys just have a big laugh. Dude, check this out. He's always trying to make the other guy feel more awkward.
Mental note.
Porn. Yeah, weird. It's whatever.
Yep. Or the guys, or the really creepy dudes who would like have like stacks and stacks of it, like older guys who from like the 70s. Like those are the guys you used to have to go to like a movie theater, and then of course you could go and rent it from like a VHS tape or something like that. Okay, so here's my point though. I don't want to get into too much detail, but you had to make effort to get those things. You had to figure out how to encrypt like a cable channel and you're like what, like 10, 12, 15, yeah.
Somewhere around. I mean, they had like Maxim magazine, which was like if you weren't ballsy enough to go get that stuff, you would just get the magazine. It'd be close.
You like you apply for like a job at like the cable company. Do you have any experience with cable? Yeah, I got lots.
Yeah.
Really? Yeah. Well, but you're only 18. Yeah. Well, I got lots of people.
It's funny you mention it, because there was more imagination to it. Like, you had to imagine more things, and I don't know what effect that had, but I know there is one, as opposed to, like, because just watching a movie, you know, where movies make you think versus now where it's just kind of spoon feeding into you. They're just not as enjoyable. So I have a feeling there's a certain effect with porn that's reflecting that.
Yes.
And maybe that's what this is tapping into.
Well, and here's, and before we move on to sort of like what's going on now, I wanted to like make this comparison, because the way that I see this, like when I look at like semen retention as sort of a thing, an internet thing, particularly within the manosphere, but I clearly it's outside the manosphere too, or NoFap. NoFap's been a thing amongst, you know, incels, MGTOW, for depending on the degree of MGTOW you are.
You can't fire me. I quit.
Yeah. And then, you know, just basic stuff. And I also hear like a lot, and I'm looking at the chat right now, a lot of guys say, well, you know, Mike Tyson was into, was it sperm retention, semen retention? And he, look at him, he's a champion.
Yeah.
He's Mike Tyson. He's like, gosh, he's what? He's hitting it, getting into his 60s right now. And he'd probably still like bash your head and kill you if he wanted to.
He's got a fight coming up, I think, next month, isn't it?
Oh, well, I did not know that.
Yeah, they're putting him back in the ring. $10 million payout. He's going to do well.
Okay, Christian, this is good, because this is sort of a segue into what I wanted to talk about. He says, I've had trouble with porn and I can stay off it for weeks, but it's hard. It's hard, man. I'm sick of it. Like I said, this whole episode, I'm sick of it being a buffer. How do I get over that? We'll talk about that a little bit here today. I'll tell you what you don't do. You don't go pay Ed Lattimore to teach you how not to stop touching your pee-pee.
Oh, Jesus.
And that's no hit on Ed, because Ed knows that I love him. But he, again, amongst the guys right now who are sort of selling this NoFap or how to stop pornography, which really means stop touching yourself. Okay. Yeah. Like maybe, I mean, some guys are going to say, well, no, it doesn't. You're going to still jerk off. You just don't have porn when you're doing it. I'm like, yeah. just like an alcoholic has like non-alcoholic beer and he'll never go back to drinking. Well, again.
That too. Like, technically with semen retention, you're allowed to have sex, but you have to not finish. But it's not the same as edging. Remember how the Mormons were big on edging? It's not that either. What you're actually supposed to do is like basically wear a ring or practice your tantra and stuff, so that way when you blow, it just reabsorbs into your body. It's a very feminine thing. Like, you know how women have a set amount of eggs over a lifetime, right? I think it's basic biology. We all understand in the chat. Yes, yes. They're trying to equate guys' sperm production the same way, where every one of those you lose, it like somebody makes the case in their research and on the subreddit and that every time you blow your load, it makes you a little older. It ages you. They're treating it like cigarettes. Yeah, one won't kill you, but if you blow your load 20 times, you're gonna age older.
Yeah. So if you have like premature wrinkles or if you have like premature gray hair,
like literally the Coomer meme, and it's this stuff. And I found when you're looking up these claims and if they're accurate or not, you can find a paper that makes a passing reference to it, but even a cursory glance at it shows you that either the paper was bunk or the research was unfounded. Or the effect was temporary and minor, except for the age one. I can't find anything where it talks about free radicals in the body at all.
That's funny.
This is strange.
Interesting. This is a good one. Semen retention is horrible for you. Sperm is meant to go one way out. NoFap is the way to go. Okay. Well, what? Huh? Always not the way to go.
Sorry. That's the other thing that's bugging me too. Conflating, because the other guy in your first chat, he was talking about addiction. I can't not do it, and it's preventing me from getting things done, which is, we can argue, is basically an addiction. That is different than NoFap.
Right, right. Yeah, and I think a lot of people, like when I put this out, it's funny, I actually published the event anyways. I announced it yesterday, and I had like something like 50 guys like instantly jumped into, like they were waiting. I'm like, how do I get 50 guys? It's not until tomorrow, like 24 hours away. But like everybody wanted to talk about it. And it's still very popular, certainly a popular tag. So there's definitely something going on. I don't mean to make light. I know you can't not laugh while you're doing this, but like when I see Ed Lattimore piling on the NoFap thing, find Jesus and stop doing porn or Pinnacle of a Man, you know, I can teach you how to stop going to X Hamster or whatever the hell, whatever his like list of like logo, you know, Pornhub logos that he's got on there. It's something that guys like have a problem with and have had a problem, or at least in, up here have a problem with.
Yeah.
And
oh, yeah, psychological dependency. It's not chemical dependency.
Yeah. Okay. So here, and then my last, just to have full disclosure here, I have a section in my upcoming fourth book that is dedicated to sex. And in there, there's a part about pornography. And I had to put it in there because for a very long time, and I mean like prior to, gosh, like 2000, maybe somewhere around mid 2000s, like right when pornography was, they didn't have like tubes, like, but there's like porn sites where you could go to and just see like static pictures and jerk off static pictures, and that was that. But now it's become something that's so immersive now, even if it's just like watching, like, you know, Pornhub or whatever.
Well, there's VR porn now. And it's not even expensive, like $1,000 glasses. There's something called Google Cardboard. I actually have one. You just put your cell phone into it, and it's got lenses that turn it into a VR experience. Mm-hmm. Pornhub apparently has like the ability to integrate with that. So it's not just Google watching movies at home, pretending you have a 60-inch screen. Mm-hmm. Then there's that, I think Vox, of all people, had a little video showing where it was like a computer-controlled... I shouldn't be doing the hand gestures on this, but like a computer controlled hand,
a Bluetooth fleshlight.
That's the one, basically. And then the girl on the other side does the motion and it does what she does. And they claim it's really great.
It's a haptic rig is what it is. It's a haptics are like, you know, feedback, force feedback kind of stuff. Yeah,
basically, yeah. But just that for your dick. So it's like the tech is there to be more real than real. And that's kind of a scary thing for me. Like I thought Demolition Man was supposed to be cool sci-fi. I didn't expect it to be real. You know what I mean?
You know, did you ever see that movie, AI? The first, that one, Steven Spielberg, I think, did that one. Do you remember that the guy that had sort of the digital wife that was waiting for him at home all the time? I guess he could bang it too. I'm not really sure, but I watched that movie once and I kind of forgot about it, except for that part. Like when I started like hearing about like sex dolls and virtual sex and that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
It's becoming more and more immersive right now. I think honestly, I think a lot of people are talking about like sex dolls and, you know, we joke about it, but I think really the virtual, like a virtual haptic rig will make that obsolete.
More likely. The only thing that could break that maybe is animatronics. If animatronics become affordable, I can see them hooking up a sex doll with like Asimov, the Honda robot.
Right. Or it'll end, I think it's probably easier for us to sort of figure out how to do like neural interfaces than it would like, I hate to sound like really sci-fi and spooky, but it's like, you know, Matrix kind of stuff. But I think that the virtual stuff will probably be more convenient, I think, than like buying like a, you know, a sex doll or a sex robot of some sorts. But I'm not saying we're not going to have that. Maybe we will at some point. But
no, I mean, they're running in parallel. One's going to win out. It's Betamax versus VHS. There's an 80s reference for you.
And again, remember what I said at the beginning of this show when we were talking about like you become, you know, decrypting, you know, cable porn or whatever. Mm-hmm. It motivated guys to do something, right? You couldn't just get the reward. You had to be a spy and be a, you know, figure out how you're going to steal the magazines, or you got to figure out how to unencrypt an encrypted stream to, you know, see Spice Channel or something like that. It motivated you to do something. And I know it sounds like really like, oh, well, that's, you know, this is because you guys are desperate, blah, blah, blah. Yeah. Most beta guys are desperate. They want to find some way to sort of solve their reproductive problems. Wouldn't it be great if we could just have like free Spice Channel, or just magazines just showed up in our, you know, our mailbox or something? I mean, you could do that, but not at under a certain age, you couldn't do that. And it was something that was sort of shameful, right? It was still something that you didn't certainly want to talk about with your guys, unless like you had a collection and he had a collection. Okay, I'll trade you this Hustler for this Cherry, whatever. Yeah,
but that's why theft was so big, because you had to pretend like you never owned it anyway. So it was just like, damn it.
Right. But it motivated you to do something. And that's sort of what I was going to, I wanted to start with here is if you look at every like substantial technological advance, particularly in media, when it comes to photography, when it comes to movies, when it comes to VHS.
Oh, porn drove all of it.
Drove all of that.
Porn is why VHS beat Betamax. Porn is why Bluetooth or Blu-ray beat HD DVD.
Right.
What else we got examples of?
Well, I mean,
Laserdisc.
In the set. Okay. Well, you know, up until Playboy was sort of a real thing back in the 60s, you know, you could still get pornography. You just had to, it was like stag films, right? It was just like this bootleg stuff that somebody shot on like whatever, you know, film Super 8. I don't know if you know what to call it, but there you can go back as far as like the late 1800s when photography was starting to become a thing.
San and Francisco has that.
The first thing they shot was beaver shot, right? Yeah, porn.
And then San Francisco has an arcade. If you go down, it's by the main touristy area, and they actually have like an old school porn machine where you crank it, throw in a quarter or a several dollar. Yeah, and you crank the thing and you watch a girl do a little dance for 15 seconds. Because probably cost $80,000 in today's currency.
That is what drives us to do things. Sex is what drives us to do things. And that's what I wanted to say. Like, you can even here's my art history my degree, my BFA paying off. Mm. When I was taking art history and I was looking at like some of the masters and the you know, like Leonardo and Michelangelo and all these other guys, and they're painting like these very super realistic for that time. It was like, oh my God, just jumped off the fresco or whatever they were painting. Yeah. Because that's the only way you could see a naked body without, like, you know, actually having sex with somebody, or it was reserved for, it was essentially pornography of the day, but it was reserved for the people who could afford it, like nobles and royalty and things like that. And so, of course, they want to oh, you're really good at this. Yeah. Here's a commission for your next piece. Please do that.
Yeah. There's
always the same drive, the same sex drive that moves these guys on to doing something else. And that, I think, is where we need to begin. Because when you're decrypting, you know, cable porn or something like that, it motivated you to do something. You had to, like, that drive, that sex drive, you're like, oh man, wouldn't it be great if I could figure out how to do this?
Yeah. Or
how can I solve, I'm not a natural alpha, so how can I solve my reproductive problem? Well, I mean, getting off is just, it's basically virtually solving that problem anyways. And so, you know, what are you going to do to make yourself, if you can't do it naturally, how can you circumvent that? How can you do an end run around that? How can you become something more than that? And I've said this before, and I'll say it again, is that pornography is sedation. And especially now, because once you've got to the point where it becomes easy to get, it's something.
It's fast food for the libido.
Yeah, exactly. It's fast food for the libido, and it paralyzes you. And I think that's why you're seeing these guys coming up saying, well, I really need to get my life together. I really need to do something new. I really need to, you know, move forward. You know, I'm rudderless in life, and you know, I need Jordan Peterson to tell me to get off my ass, or I need something to, you know, to motivate me.
Literally anybody offline, anybody online with the smallest clout can tell some of these guys what to do. I am amazed how quickly Dad 2.0 takes hold. People were asking me what to do with their life when I had 500 followers. I was nobody. It was eye-opening how savagely desperate people are. Can you, like, I don't know. I'm sure you've gotten a lot of, like, tell me how to live my life, essentially. There's no way you haven't. You probably still do.
I get, every morning I wake up and I got two more in my inbox, actually. Like, what should I do? What should I do? How do I do this? How do I get rid of that? How do I increase my SMB? That's the most popular. It used to be, how do I get my girlfriend back? Now it's, how do I increase my SMB?
Which is crazy, because we have, like, there's a lot of stuff in there. I'm going through it right now, the Married Man Sex Life Primer on my YouTube channel. We're doing the series. And it's literally about a male action plan, how to increase your SMV. It's within the confines of a relationship, but it's the same approach for everything. Physically attractive, mentally build up your alpha qualities, leave your beta qualities where they are, and then be more honest with your intentions. It's essentially it. And there's a huge roadmap for it. Like, we've already spelled it out, but that's not good enough. People still want it spoon-fed. They need a father figure to give it to them. They need an aspirational model. They need a Michael Jordan poster on their wall.
I think that, and here's what I was going to say, and I'll get to your question here in just a second, because this is a good one here. But this is actually a pretty good quote here from J.P. Green. He says, you know, porn is the sigh of the oppressed creature, the heart of the heartless world, and the soul of the soulless condition. Okay, now we're going to get into woo-woo magical thinking about this, which is something I also want to touch on today, too. Actually, that was the main thing I wanted to touch on today. I guess you said pornography. It is the opium of the incels. But it's the opium of a lot of other people, too. And how do I know that it's not just for incels? Because 68% of, probably closer to 70 now, at least 68% of evangelical Christian men claim to be addicted to pornography, have admitted to being addicted to pornography.
I wish they would quantify that, by the way.
Yeah. What constitutes addiction? Like, it's a problem for them in some fashion. And again, I hate that I have to actually, you know, put a caveat on this, but This is not an endorsement. Okay. We're not endorsing pornography with this. We cannot analyze this. We cannot talk about this unless we have like an open and frank conversation about the whole thing. So if I say pornography this, pornography that, it doesn't mean like, hey guys, as soon as this is over, make sure you open that other window in your browser and go stroke one out. That's not what I'm saying. Okay. No, because we live in the age of emotionalism combined with binary extremes. Rollo just did a whole 2-hour live stream and he said everybody should just get their dick out. No, that's not what I'm saying. So,
I didn't get no affiliates from no OnlyFans. They start paying. I'll think about it.
I think it's the Bulletproof Coffee. I'm sorry, but maybe I've done it too long.
Oh, it's fine. I'm on liquid caffeine, so I'm on same wavelength. Same wavelength.
I know. Whenever I sort of lose it on Rule Zero, I'm like. Let's see what else. I wanted to bring out the fact that I do understand, and this is the other thing, semen retention is avoiding porn and masturbation and avoiding porn and masturbation are two different
things. No, it's not.
How else are you going to retain it? You can still have healthy masturbation without porn. Okay. Yeah, you can. Are you going to?
All right. So here, I'll bring up the study here for this one. Okay. I actually looked into it. The subreddit was a great source because it led me to all this research, primary research the guys were using. It's collated together. Some of the claims that the guys made for what is the benefits of semen retention. First off, notice how vague these all are. It's a big list. A greater sense of purpose. Improved self-conscious.
Well, hold on, Ryan. You want me to put this up for you?
Oh, sure. I guess if you want.
Is this what you're reading from right now?
Yeah, this one right here.
Okay, hang on one second.
Greater sense of purpose, improved self-confidence, a better memory, increased energy, increased muscle growth, improved concentration, focus, interest, creativity, greater joy. This sounds like they're promising everything, but none of it is objective. What does improved creativity mean to you? It's completely subjective. Greater joy, completely subjective. Right. These are the kind of things, and this is what they promised for semen retention, that if you do them, if you think you have it, you have it. Mm-hmm. If I have a better memory, I don't remember the things I forgot. So I don't know if my memory is any better or not. Improve charisma. This one was kind of laughable because guys make the case that girls want you to, or you want to stand out. Girls will sell you on it. Where is this? It's like later on down here. Not that it matters, but they like a guy who has control over his sense of purpose. It's like, it's exactly the stuff that people rag on you guys like you or me for, that you're promising magical pills to get inside a girl's pants. It's this female worship wrapped around this great woo-woo magic spirituality. Mm-hmm. And this is where I went in. Okay, so they're talking about better memory, energy, and muscle growth. So they're essentially saying it increases your testosterone. Mm-hmm. There's not a lot of studies on it, but of the ones that do, I've managed to find the Apex study, the most current one. I think came out 2003. It's already researched and cited everything else out there. Here was their findings. Testosterone increases the most when you're having sex. Secondly, if you're watching sex, and then the baseline takes no changes, abstaining from it. Mm-hmm. This is the best example they had in the field because they found if you did it in a lab and somebody jerked you off in an fMRI machine, it actually taints the study. It's like you were saying about, when you measure something, it changes its quality.
Observing a process changes the process.
And I'm not going to waste your time here either, but every single one of these things, if you look into it, they all come to the same conclusion. They make perfect sense until you look into them with the smallest amount of scrutiny. Mm.
So that's the scientific findings of this, at least from what we can dig up. Now, you can't discount sort of like the, I don't say the placebo effect, but certainly the psychological effect of making that kind of change in your life. Now, I'm gonna throw a curve at you here because I've written about this. Actually, I don't think it's been in any of my books, but I have a very kind of, I won't say, it's a seminal post called The Pheromonal Beta. And in that, people thought I was like all about semen retention or I was about NoFap when I wrote that. I'm not. I was just trying to sort of understand why it is that we find masturbation for men to be shameful. But for women, we see it as like, it's a niche of porn, right? It's like, yeah, all right. I mean, let's get onto the masturbation videos for the girls, right? Or a girl using a vibrator or two girls doing each other. Like, why is that something that we get off on? Whereas like if a guy is like out there, like stroking it, like we arrest him, You know, we want him out. We want him gone. Or we you know, that's like probably, I would say, I mean, unless you're like a gay male, that's probably the least popular like video that's out there. In fact, sending a dick pic right now, nobody complains about, nobody says, oh, nobody is getting charged for sexual harassment for a woman sending like boob pics or cooter pics. They're not sending those. That doesn't get you arrested. A dick pic does. You'll lose your life. You'll lose your livelihood. You'll lose your family. You'll lose everything. If you just so much as send a shot of a hard wiener to whoever, right? That ends up becoming something that is like blackmail material, mm-hmm. but not for women, not for women. It's only for guys. So well, there's
starting a little bit, but even then, what was that senator you guys had? The one that was having orgies in that?
Oh, that was the governor. That was, it wasn't Harry Reid was a senator. It was, not Sisolak, but the other dude. I know who you're talking about. Yeah, it was in the news not too long ago. Yeah. How we were getting after it with one of his staff members.
Granted, better off than Anthony Weiner, but she still, no, it was the girl.
Yeah. Well, she was the wife of one of his staff members, and he started banging her, and she was into, no, you're talking about Katie Hill.
That's the one.
Katie Hill was like California. That was just recently. That was just last year, I think, just at the end of last year. Katie Hill was a congresswoman from California, and she had a sort of poly relationship. And so she was like banging her staff members, and her husband was all about it until she started getting with another guy who she liked better than him. And he got jealous. And that's when all those pictures started coming out.
That's the one. She did better than Anthony Weiner did.
Yeah, but you're not going to get Katie Hill. You know, women generally aren't going to get sexual harassment charges if they send a picture of a, you know, a cooter to whoever. It's the other way around. Or like for men, jerking off is a failure. It's like a perversion. There's something wrong with you if you're doing that.
Yeah, because you're not blowing inside of a girl.
It's empowering. It's something like, oh, you go, girl. Yeah, we can't rely on those men. You self pleasure. What was it? I'm gonna toss a bone to the MGTOW crew here because I heard this on TFM's show, and he was talking about, like, of course he always talks about sex dolls and stuff like that, but that's not the only thing. Fleshlights and some other things are sort of something that he endorses as well. But he did make a really interesting case one time. And he was talking about how women can go and have like these sex parties, right? Like here's a dildo party. It's like almost like Tupperware, only like we're going to show you the latest, you know, purple saguaro or whatever it is, you know, like the sex toys, basically, or lingerie. And you get your girlfriends together and you all get together and you have wine and cheese and whatever. And you talk about like, here's the latest thing. Here's the pocket rocket or whatever. And that's acceptable. And girls get together and it's a good time. Guys cannot do that. Men are not allowed to do those things because they're not supposed to be jerking off. There's something, and I would say that it's not just a societal thing. I think that it is like, and I wrote about this in the Pheromonal Beta, is that for a guy to masturbate, it is a concession of failure. Like you had to, if you go and you look at like primates, the alpha male is the one who's doing all the banging. The beta males are the ones who masturbate more than anything else, especially in bonobo societies, but also like in other primates as well. And if they get sexual access at all, it's to females because they have transactional agreements. Basically, you bring me bananas, you pick nits off of me, or you watch the alpha male's kids while I'm away banging the alpha male. Then you can have access to me when I'm not an estrus. And that's how that works for them. But so it seems to me like if you are like, masturbation is shameful. It's always been something religious too, right? I mean, it's like you'll go blind if you keep touching it, right? Nobody really worried so much about women doing it, but when guys did it, it was something shameful. You weren't supposed to do that. That's what we call a guy a jerk off. You're a jerk off. Like that's an insult, right? It's an invective. Like why is that? And so I was asking those questions. And I started thinking about it in terms of like evolution. Like why would a guy who, you know, masturbates, why would that be seen as a failure or shame? And I would suggest that it's very, I'd say it's rooted in the fact that, and this is going to sound very Freudian, I understand, but all energy is sexual. And I mean, energy is in the terms of like motivation and incentive. I don't mean it like, ooh, here's my magic crystal to shove up my butt. What are you going to use that sexual frustration for? Are you going to use it to decrypt cable TV? Are you going to use it to, how are you going to use it? Like, are you going to use it creatively or are you going to use it destructively? How are you going to go about that? And as we know, I think that, the majority of men are beta men. So they have to find some way to solve their reproductive problem by getting creative. That's where you get the creative side of things. I think the terms that they use in that list that you were just talking about, you're going to be more creative, you're going to have more joy, you're going to do this, you're going to be able to do all of those esoteric things are things we want to encourage in beta men who aren't reproducing or who reproduce less or theoretically.
Yeah, Tesla, make us another AC power. We'll handle the fucking. You just handle that.
Yeah, exactly. So take that energy and use it towards creative ends, right? Advanced civilization, we'll be over here reproducing. And pretty much that's what it comes down to, I think, it's sort of like, what are you going to do with the energy that you have from, and I mean energy incentive, that is derived, let's say, from sexual frustration.
Here, a thing on your chat too. A lot of these guys, like when Rollo said we did our research, we did. You're throwing a few reports at me and I've read all of them. I've done my research. The one study they're talking about has how a mice with semen retention were increasing their levels of hormones and that. If you actually go and read the paper, results were inconclusive, temporary, and more research is needed to make a case. It's basically opening a line of inquiry. It's not deciding things. I've gone through all of that stuff. I've gone through the other ones where they do it in MRI machines to show the effects. I've gone through the ones that show that testosterone boost from retaining. All of this stuff says temporary, one time, and the results are so low. Like saying you boost your testosterone if you abstain from sex for 7 days. Yeah, but it's not a lot. It's like a couple percentage points over absolute. So don't think it's like getting a shot of tren. It's barely anything. Even the other study here, which I'm bringing, and I've linked in here a couple times, and I know nobody's read it.
If you put it up, I'll share it.
Yeah, here, I'll put it in. Copy this right now to date is the best research between sex, masturbation, or watching porn or nothing, increasing your testosterone. Doesn't matter your age, doesn't matter your time of day, it doesn't matter about your circadian rhythm. Having sex ups your testosterone more than every other element on here, and the effects aren't strong enough for any noticeable differences. So unless you're having sex every 4 hours, which a refractory period means you cannot be doing that, you're not going to get any noticeable amount of testosterone. You'll actually get a much better effect by going out and sitting in the sun all day and tanning. So yeah, don't come at with these talking points. Like, I've read the things, I've seen the talking points. You guys really should do your research. The fact that you haven't done research lets me know that it's not about learning the research. There's an underlying issue here, and I want you to understand. Rollo has talked about it immensely. Turning this vice into a virtue. It's a sexless, aimless type of situation, and you have to attach a science to it, and that absolves one person of responsibility. It's a weird martyrdom narcissism to it. It's not my fault I'm not having sex. I'm actually doing this positive thing. Well, what are the effects of the positive thing? Even you guys talking about it in here. Well, I'm keeping more zinc in me. Does anybody know what the effects of zinc are on the body in the chat here without Googling it right now so you can throw a link at me?
Probably not.
So it's clearly a post hoc rationalization.
What's your perspective on sexual transmutation? Is that a thing?
He's talking like tantra and stuff like that. That's the other thing. So they've really latched on to like that.
I want to get to the shamanism crap about this. So
Save it till then because that's where it kind of fits.
Yeah. So yeah, and I hear what you're saying. It's observing a process changes a process. That's the observer effect. The other one is what you call sunk cost theory. Is that right? Like you can't.
I don't know if it's sunk cost. It might be a marketing plan. It's just essentially like the Ben Franklin effect. The more investment you put into something, the more future investment you put in.
Or the more is it opportunity cost? Is that what it is? Maybe I'm wrong about that. I will say this though, and I use this in the essay that I was talking about. I think it was a pheromonal beta. Maybe I'm misquoting, but anyways, when I was studying behavioral psychology, one of the experiments, I guess, I came across when I was learning about observing the process, change the process, the observer effect. When people know that they're being observed, they change their behavior. Also, when they know that they're being studied or they're in a study, they will change their behavior. The other thing is this, is that when, and this is the experiment, there was, they got a group of across several colleges. It wasn't just at one college, but, and I'm paraphrasing here. I'm not really sure where I remember this from, but they got a group of college kids who were sort of getting like low grades, like C's and D's, somewhere around there. And they said, okay, we have this free tutorship kind of thing that will help you increase your grades, and it'll take you like what, 2 or 3 months to do the tutorship. And then, you know, people signed up for it, so they had a lot of people doing it. And but the thing is that the class was actually structured not to help them out, like to literally not help them get
better. I remember this. Yeah.
And so what would happen is they would see the results, like they go from a C to a D. Or they go from like a C minus to a D minus or something like that. They would drop it. And, you know, afterwards, of course, they let them know what was going on. But they did this, and they polled the kids, you know, the college students afterwards. And they said, you know, how did you feel about the class? Did you think you benefited from this class? Clearly, after they got lower grades because of it. And they said, yeah, it was really time well spent. I really think it was really good. And they all had a very positive impression of the 2 months, 3 months that they effectively wasted in class, and provably did not improve themselves, but they still felt like it was time well spent.
Because the alternative was that they were gullible, they got hoodwinked, they wasted their time, and that they failed. That's the alternative. Right. And rather than accept that, we have a self-delusion mechanism. I don't know how it works to turn our failures into successes in our own mind.
Okay. Let me ask you this. From what you were able to tell, what is the difference between NoFap and sperm or semen retention?
It's okay. So NoFap is just nothing. Don't touch your dick. Don't let your dick touch anything.
No edging.
Well, semen retention was about that part. You were allowed to have sex, but you have to hold it in. You basically put a ring over yourself, so that way, as you blow, it reabsorbs into the body. But it's different than edging. You're not supposed to edge, because edge is about removing all of the good feelings from it. This one is supposed to be, yeah, you're just literally not giving your semen. And it's just a very feminized way of trying to turn the infinite amount of sperm we produce into like a limited quantity thing like eggs. It's literally guys turning themselves into defective women. And I know they don't think of it that way. And I know a lot of you guys are probably like calling me an idiot because you don't believe me. Here's the thing though. Like, I've read all the same stuff you do. I'm not invested in this one way or the other. You guys can NoFap or retain all you want. Doesn't kill me one way or the other. But reading through this stuff, it's like the guys aren't reading what they're doing. And like you said, every positive benefit is always vague, fungible. Like, what is the guy? There's one guy in the chat. They're just telling me, just try it. Just try it. Just try it.
Right.
That's like, yeah, you just got to put this bucket on your head right now. I'm like, well, let me see who's doing it and who's succeeding. Show me somebody who's like, this literally saved my life on there publicly doing it. Maybe you have a case for that, but I don't see that. I saw a lot of people typing it.
Well, and I'm looking in the chat here too. And I'll get to you in just a second. But, so I'm looking at this, and a lot of people say, well, you know, you won't know until you try it, or you'll feel so much better if you do this. And it's like, so basically bring yourself to the point of like getting off, and then like, don't. And then just go back to doing whatever you're doing kind of thing. I first
tried that, by the way, with my girl. She hates it. They treat it as sexual rejection, and they go nuts. Yeah.
Well, I mean, there's that release side of the whole thing too. So I'm not an endocrinologist, just so everybody knows. I'm not, you know, a hormone therapist or anything like that. But so what I was going to say is that maybe there is a benefit in the sense that like these guys, I don't want to say it's psychosomatic, but like maybe there's something like they feel like different because they did something different.
Yeah.
Like,
did something.
Yeah. Rather than getting off, they, and experiencing the oxytocin and the relaxation and everything else that comes after that, because you can make a case for masturbation as well, right? You can say, well, it relaxes you. It releases these positive hormones. Yeah. I've looked at, Lay Miller, what's his name? I think he is the husband or poly lover of, what's her face from Quillette, Claire Lay Miller. I think he is her husband of some sort. They're sexologists, right? And And so he studies this stuff, and he's not like for it or against it. He just kind of throws these things out there. And of course, a lot, he probably came to a lot of the same conclusions that you did. But if you say anything right now, if you go and you say, well, you know, this is the actual numbers right here. And this is the actual, here's the empirical data on this. People are still going to fight you on it. I think really, particularly for men, like, you notice that it's not, there's no women who are like nofap. There are no women that are nofap. And if that was the case, would it not benefit women as well? Like not getting off or getting up to the point and then not, or is it just because it's sperm and we have some magical juju in our sperm that like makes us, reabsorbs our energy back into our chi or some shit like that. I learned about this and this is no cut on him, but like Hotep Jesus told me about this. He was talking about like how, was it Buddhist monks or something like that, dude, sperm. Was monks. Yeah. And how it was so that, and look at the great life that they're all living, you know? what happens, I think, is a lot of guys real, and this is why I think this is psychosomatic, is because guys really want to associate this with, like, I don't know, you know,
samurai and ninja and, yeah, monks, exactly, and all these noble archetypes,
or it's like some Sherpa taught them how to do it on the top of some mountain in Tibet somewhere, and here's how you retain your chi and live a better, more positive life because you're doing these things. And okay, I get it, but what I think is happening right now is that because we have such access to pornography right now, every guy feels in some way bad for spanking it more than once a day. I don't know what your habit is, but like this guy, for example, was it Gilbert? I'll put this up there. So I used to do it every 3 times a day, and I quit. I noticed a massive change in my motivation to date women after quitting. I had to work on myself. So I don't know. It's hard for me to say that like this is like, if there is a benefit at all to semen retention, I think it's here.
Yeah, because, well, I was going to reference B.F. Skinner, his pigeon experiment. And I think that's what you're seeing here. Do you know, are you familiar with this one?
I believe so.
Yeah, well, I guess for the audience, you guys may not know this. So B.F. Skinner had this thing where there was a cage, put a pigeon into it, and then there was a machine that would dispense food pellets. Completely random. Nothing changed other than just random things throughout the day. And what he noticed after a time, the pigeons would start developing elaborate routines and rituals. Spin around 3 times here, spin around 2 times here, flap your wings twice, and then they'd get a food pellet. And just from the strict, and this is why the concept of the p-value in a study, like, well, how likely is it that random chance caused this effect and not what we're studying here? So what they found is that we are so primed to look for patterns, we will invent patterns ourselves and take a little bit of correlation and make it work. So you always have to be, now here, let's say nofap and semen retention, absolutely real. You don't know that though. And the fact that a lot of the guys have not taken an empirical, self-aware look at it, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe it's just random chance that this stuff's working. Maybe, like you said, maybe it's a placebo effect, but there's lacking that critical skill to reflectively look at oneself. Instead, it's like, nope, I did the course. My grades are better.
Right.
And that's the thing that worries me. And I think that's the bigger issue than just, are you going to put your hand on your dick or wear a cock ring or what? It's that guys are willing to try anything. And as long as it doesn't kill them, they will buy into it as if it's a religion. And we kind of are seeing a lot of the detriment that comes with that attitude of thinking.
Right.
I don't want to draw the connection to between that and like Portland, but that's an extreme version of what I'm talking about here.
Well, yeah. And then I'll draw that conclusion. I already have actually in a couple of previous videos, is that these the same, you know, disaffected, you know, white kids that you see out there throwing Molotov cocktails around are the same guys who are just don't know what to do with themselves. They're the same. What is it? Lost Boys that Jordan Peterson was trying to reach just 2 years ago, right? Year and a half ago. And so they're out there and they're, what are they going to do? Right. That's social for them. You know, that's something to get out there and, you know, well, we got nothing else to do. Let's all go out and get together. And this will be something for us, to do.
Yeah.
And then of course you see a lot of women, a lot of girls that are out there as well. And I think it's more of a social occasion for a good portion of these guys. I'm not saying everyone's like that, but it's that sexual angst. I've said this in I think it might have been,
haven't you?
Well, it's It's solving your reproductive problem. And how do you go about doing that? I've said before is like, there's no such thing as contentment for human beings. It's like every human that you know is discontent and they will be till the day that they die. That's a good thing. It's okay. It's how you deal with that discontent that makes you or breaks you. So like a lot of guys, you know, like I'm going to retain my semen and be just like the Buddhist monks in Tibet or something like that. And it's like, yeah, you'll do that for a little while until you want to do something else, until there's something else that comes around that's, you know, you think I'll just be content and just meditate here all day long. And it's,
yeah. And I've been hearing your chat at the point.
Meditate, but addiction.
It's like, yeah, we're not talking about addiction though. Like addiction part, we're all fine. If you have to do something to get your hand off your dick 12 times a day, not going to lament you for that, but that's not the claims being made. In fact, nowhere in anything I've looked up for semen retention was shedding a porn addiction mentioned. Mm-hmm. So I think that's a very disingenuous thing to slip in there at the back end.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I got this question and I know this isn't a super, but it was kind of where I was going to go at one point. It's in my notes here, my show notes here. So people are talking about the pheromonal beta. So what I was saying before, and maybe you just came in on this, is that when I was writing the pheromonal beta, I was looking for reasons why masturbation would be either a plus or minus for somebody, right? I'm trying to look at it in an objective fashion. Like, why is it failure for women and failure for men? And it's like a niche of porn for women. Well, for women, when a woman is masturbating, that's a cue. That's a cue of sexual availability. She's saying, she's signaling, her legs are spread and she's really doing herself. That means come on over here to men's hindbrain. That's why that's a niche of porn. And it will always be a niche of porn. You'll get off, like more people will get off on that than they'll get off on, you know, guys doing it themselves. So there is that. That's easy. It's easy to say why is masturbation something that is, you know, for women is a plus. For men, it's always going to be a minus because it means I can't get a real woman, so I've got to take care of myself. And again, what that goes against is it goes against the idea of competency, alpha, you know, prowess, let's just say. Mm-hmm. It goes against dominance, because if you're a dominant male, you wouldn't have to do that. You will be getting off with an actual real life human woman or primate, you know, ape, whatever. But I know where you're going to go with this. So let me explain here, because a lot of guys are saying, well, what about the pheromonal beta? Should you, I made this case and I'll stick by this too. Is, did you ever see that movie? Of course you did. Something About Mary, mm-hmm. right? And remember when I forget the guy's name, but he who's saying, oh, you can't go out there with a loaded gun. You have to go jerk off before you go out with this girl. Otherwise you're going to be, too eager. Or you're going to be too in her face, or you're going to be too, you know, you're going to act differently.
Yeah. And you've made the case that, well, that hunger is what allows you to perform, makes you more attractive. Girls are actually attracted to a guy who's sexually dominant.
Right. So there's a qualitative difference between like saying, okay, I'm going to go be a monk on some mountaintop and withhold my sperm and then not use that for some, because really what is that sexual angst for? To get you to solve problems, to get you to figure out how to, you know, unencrypt cable porn or whatever it is. Maybe you want to be an attorney. Maybe you want to, like, whatever's motivating you. Remember, discontent has to be something, has to be somewhat of a motivator for you, either destructively or creatively. And that's what I was saying in that post, is that when you are the guy that is jerking off because you want to feel like the oxytocin relaxation of, you know, after remember that testosterone and is a pre-orgasm hormone. Oxytocin is a post-orgasm hormone. Mm-hmm. So that's like, oh man, yeah, I love you too. I love you too. I love, you know, we're gonna stay together forever. Yeah, I love you. You're the one. That's oxytocin talking.
Yeah,
I want to bang you right now, like a wild animal. Is the testosterone talking?
Well, and the dopamine essentially. But you can basically equate those hormones with alpha and beta.
Yeah,
that's the part that I like. A lot of people don't understand.
Okay, and then where are you going to go with this? Because Apple K talked about this. Like, there's the beta side and there's the oxytocin side. You have to remember that men do not produce oxytocin in the same amounts that women do, and oxytocin for women is a post orgasm feeling. Mm-hmm. So it was funny. I've read stuff by Claire Laymiller, I think is what her name, the sexologist stuff. All right, maybe it was Meredith Chivers. I can't remember, but they were saying, what is the, like, why would women have orgasms? Why would it matter for them to have orgasms? Well, first of all, it's motivation to have sex. And then second of all, post-orgasm, women experience a much like more flushed, I guess, result of oxytocin flowing into their systems. Mm-hmm. So afterwards, it's like, not only did I have a great orgasm with this guy because he knows what he's doing, now I want to stick with him because I feel all of these feelings for the guy afterwards as a result of that, the oxytocin flood that comes after the orgasm.
Yeah, so it's a comfort building thing. For some reason, it equates to or it correlates with guys who are willing to take care of her orgasm are also more willing to take care of children later on. So it selects for that kind of guy.
Mm-hmm. So there's a behavioral side of this too. So that's what I wanted to get. That was what I was actually, I didn't realize I was doing it at the time, but when I was writing the pheromonal beta, that's really what I was getting at, is that when you don't jerk off, when you retain your semen, if there is any benefit, I still think it's a psychological. I'm not saying you don't feel differently because you're doing something differently. How could you not, right? If you start exercising, guess what? You're going to feel great because suddenly you're flooded with endorphins and the and things that you know you're looking a little better, you're feeling a little better. Maybe you're going a little more regularly, or it's like a runner's high. Yeah. Right? If you run far enough and you stop, you're going to get that kind of endorphin rush because your body flushes you with adrenaline and all that other good stuff. So yeah, you're definitely going to feel different after that. And you're also going to manifest different behaviors as a result of that. And that's what I got into in the pheromonal beta. And that's what happens to women once they have an orgasm, and men as well. So when I was watching something about Mary, and Mary puts the jizz in her hair and she's, it's like that. I was actually going to use that as the thumbnail, but I thought it was just too obvious to use that. But so when a guy tells you, yeah, you need to go rub one out before you go, or you're going to be too desperate, what he's doing is actually, honestly, he's ignorant or he's trying to sabotage your chances with that girl, because you will act and behave differently if you have this kind of like, it's pre-release as opposed to post-release.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So it's not so much like I got more testosterone if I don't jerk off. Great. No, it's not that. It's you have less oxytocin in your system before you do that. Because if you do that the relaxation doesn't come from like the release, it comes from the oxytocin that comes after the release.
People forget there's a lot of hormone exchange during the money shots. Like girls too. This guy in your chat, Bill something or other, he's saying, don't give a girl your energy. Here's something that you're going to learn in a relationship. When you orgasm in a girl, she actually gets testosterone from you, which increases her sex drive. And the reason I say you'll know this, here's something you can replicate if and when and wherever your girlfriends are. Have sex and then notice a frequency of how much sex you have based on how much sex you've had. If you're having sex every day, you're more likely to have sex every day. Take 3 days off and notice her sex drive wanes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it's not like not giving a girl your energy. Again, that's something that works completely detrimental to what you're trying to do. If you want to have a healthy sex life, which most guys, I think we could say we all do, right? Literally the best way to have a sex life, have a healthy sex life, is to have a frequent, healthy sex life. And that's why it's so hard to get out of that feedback loop of, like you said, pheromonal beta stuff, because you need to get that first one under your belt. That's why slump busters are a thing. You guys heard of this? Do I mention this in the channel?
No, it's okay. You can mention it. Well, we're after an hour. Go ahead.
All right. Yeah. You sleep with a girl you otherwise wouldn't like. Maybe she's a fatty. Maybe you aren't into her. Maybe she's been hounding you all the time. Whatever. Just getting that one out of your system ups your testosterone levels, like we said from the report. It gives her more testosterone. It makes people more sexual around you. And so it's more likely that you're going to have sex. And this is how hormonally pre-selection plays out.
Mm-hmm.
Girls see a guy who's having a bunch of sex. He's surrounded by a bunch of women who like him sexually. And they assume he's going to have more testosterone. It's a subliminal thing, but he's going to have more of the oxytocin and more of the testosterone that I crave. And so it's almost like seeing a guy who's got a lot of people he's dealing crack to. That's the guy you want to buy crack from. Same thing, but with sex. And it blows your mind once you start replicating this stuff. Like I just said.
Garrow here says releasing causes relaxation in the body. Well, actually, it's
the oxytocin
that causes that. But yeah, for a brief period of time. Yes, because the oxytocin ends up deteriorating our system. Yeah, right?
The refractory period.
Right. Okay. And so this kills desire. I would say that it motivates different behavior. You're still going to. And again, that also depends. So he says, keep yourself busy with that desire. Don't waste it. That's really the point, I think, that guys try to overemphasize with semen retention. And I mean, maybe to a lesser degree, NOFAP. Mm-hmm. Because I'm trying to make the distinction here because people are going to throw rocks at me. He doesn't know what semen retention is. what I'm seeing anyways, from what I, from the, what we, the homework that we've done, is that there is a qualitative difference in your behavior if you do those things. If you're not sedated, really think about it. What did I say about like pornography is sedation? I mean that in the literal sense. Like if you're putting, if I injected you with oxytocin right now, that would sedate you. That would make you feel a whole lot differently. Your emotional state, it's a mood altering drug, right? It would, your emotional state would change as a result of that. Same thing with alcohol. Same thing with prescription opiates, those kinds of things.
You want SSRIs, like the list is, SSRIs. That's the whole point of hormones are behavior changers.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And so I can change your emotional state and how you feel about things according to whatever I pump into your body. And you're going to behave differently as a result of those. Like, that's why antidepressants work. Oh, I'm depressed all the time. Okay, take this. Oh, now I feel okay. Yeah, yeah. Phil, yeah, you, Ryan, you don't know. You've never taken them. So how would you know until you just take them for a month? Take these SSRIs and things will change for you, Ryan.
Yeah, I have taken them. And I'll tell you right now, don't ever take them. They're horrible. Horrible. They're the worst thing. I don't, you mind if I rant on SSRIs for a second?
Go ahead. I'll tell you what my, I've never taken them, but I know people who have. Go ahead.
Yeah. The military got me on them for a little while there. Here's what happens. Yeah. Your lows become muted, but so do your highs. And here's the part. It's a chemical castration. It literally mutes your ability to have feelings down below. You end up having to beat your meat like it's owes you money. You end up having to pound your girl as if you're trying to start a fire in there. It just compels all your libido. And it has a weird effect. And this is why I have a feeling that sex is a lot harder for a lot of guys today, because so many girls are on SSRIs. It mm-hmm. literally has chemically castrated their libido, and for guys too. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, is that about where you were going with this?
Well, I was going to say this is that the people that I've known who have taken them, I've known both men and mostly women, but I've known men to say this as well, is that they're like, never get on these things. I'm like, why is that? And he says, because they make you not care about it. It's like, he's like, oh, what do they take away your happiness? He said, no, he says, they don't, you know, they just make you just, you're ambivalent to everything because for whatever reason, it blocks that. I don't know what the hell it blocks, but that's what it reduces, or it numbs that particular.
It blocks serotonin. The SSRI.
you basically don't. SSRIs, by the way, are antidepressants. So people know, I'm getting questions here for that. So they're antidepressants, and they essentially block or limit the whatever the pathway is for you to actually give a shit about something, you know, like emotional. I don't know how they work chemically, but from what I've heard from guys is like, they're just like, you just don't care. And you lose your libido as a result of that because you don't care, you know. Yeah.
But it's not even that you just emotionally don't care. Like physically, your body doesn't care. Like you lose feeling. Mm-hmm.
This is okay. Oh, this is a good one. Let me throw this one out there real quick. Thanks, Amar. He says, I have observed in gym being noticed more by ladies when on PMO.
Is that semen retention or is that an SSRI or?
I'm not really sure. Some couldn't control looking while being with their boyfriends. So I think what he's saying is that there's, what was it? There used to be an old, I was laughing with you before when we came on, I was talking about the movie Rocky.
Yeah.
Where Mickey, was it Mickey? Yeah, Mickey was telling Rocky, he says, you know, no sex before a big fight. And he's like, why? He's like, because women make you weak in the knees, Rock.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And I'll give you my Mickey's impression. But that used to be the thing is a lot of guys would say, well, I'm not going to have sex before I do the Tour de France. I'm not going to have sex before I do a big fight. I'm not going to have, like, I think it was it Conor McGregor who said that he never has sex before, or he always has sex before a big fight. I'm not really sure.
I wish I could remember. I missed a lot of his promo stuff, which is probably why I didn't get so hyped for it.
Yeah. Yeah. I get that. I know that there's a superstitious element to it, I think, where you're like, okay, if I do this, and I guess I understand, but here's the thing. It's not, I understand why the superstition would exist.
Yeah.
Because it's almost like metaphorical truth. Are you familiar with the metaphorical truth argument from like Brett Weinstein's?
Yeah.
So it's better to behave as if it is true. Because what it does is it motivates you. You know, that frustration, that angst is something that's going to motivate you to victory. That's going to motivate you to defeat a rival. So if you think about that, the guys that the primates that are jerking off all the time are soaked in oxytocin, or who have sort of like, you know, been resigned to their own fate of being the beta male, they're not going to challenge the alpha male if they're always jerking off and they're just always relaxing. Like, yeah, man, it's okay. We're just, you know,
PMO, premature ovulation? Dude.
Is that what that is?
That's what this one guy in the chat is saying. Guys don't have ovulation.
I don't have ovulation, dude.
There's no way that's real. They got to be messing with us.
I think what he's saying is like women can't help looking at him in.
Now, is that it? Or is it that he's paying attention because he wants to see that effect? We right. see what we want to see. Don't forget that. Again, the guys in the chat arguing with us, it's not that we're taking a stance saying this is BS. There's nothing to it. The mm-hmm. part that worries me is that nobody in the chat thought to take a sober second look at this stuff. And what if I'm wrong? Not even a chance. You right. bought well, into it hook, line, and sinker. And that's scary because that's how cult leaders get started.
This is it right here. Porn, masturbation, orgasm. I think I guess that's like the standard operating procedure for you know.
I don't jerk off and now all of a sudden chicks want me. So you're looking for it, man. And
orgasm is like the, let me, because I saw this a little bit before. I'm like, okay, so this is the process. So is this the process? Like, if you can eliminate these things, then suddenly you'll live a better life. You know, like I don't know. Like, okay. So here's the thing. This is from Amar. So I don't want to dismiss this because I think this is actually kind of on topic anyways.
All right. And
that's what he said. I can't put it back up, but he said, I have observed in the gym being noticed by more women when it's no porn, masturbation, orgasm. Okay. So, I get that. And here's why I think that might be something that's true, because your behavior changes as a result of that, not because of the actual, I got this super, you know, juju flowing through my body because I didn't do that. It's because your behavior changes. It's exactly what I said about the pheromonal beta. So what will your behavior be if the guy goes out, like the guy who jerked off and she puts the jizz in his hair, like that guy who's already had the orgasm, and he's already swimming in oxytocin, what will his behaviors be? What will manifest in his behaviors? Like, maybe he's not even like aware of it. It might be subconsciously that he's manifesting these behaviors because he's relaxed, because right. he got off, because he had an orgasm, because he has oxytocin in his system.
He just doesn't look for chicks with eyeballing him.
Yeah, exactly. What are his priorities? Like, why, who cares? I'm sedated technically because I've experienced release and satisfaction and everything. It's not a plus. The guy who didn't feel release, the guy who retained everything, I was going to say retains his sperm, but whatever, but he didn't jerk off before the date. That guy's going to behave differently than the guy who did jerk off before he went on the date. And that those behaviors and that attitude and the words you choose, your body language, everything, like all the things that women are sensitive to that guys have no idea that they're sensitive, like, oh, look, he wore nice shoes, right? All of these things that women like pick up on because they have the hypergamous filter. Oh, he's using these words. He's speaking in this tone. He looks like this. Look where his eyes are going. He's you know, he's using Kino. All these things that would say that he really wants to get with me. Or right. is he the guy that jerked off before the date and he's like, doesn't really care. And he's not really into it. And he's just really relaxed and chill, a chill guy, right? Like, that does you no favors. So I would suggest this. I said this in the pheromonal beta. I said,
right.
don't jerk off before you go on a date, because God forbid a woman would actually think that you might want to have sex with her at some point.
Well, let me posit this to you then. So on this same line of thinking,
literally, it changes you.
Yeah. Let's say we can admit that some guys who jerk off just before a date probably can still go and get laid with the girl. They probably still want to. Let's say if the difference between that little bit of oxytocin you get between jerking off and not jerking off before meeting a girl, whether you have sex or not, if that is the only thing standing in the way between you and pussy paradise, would you consider this then the magic pill of a life well lived? Or would you consider there to be much lower hanging fruit that you can deal with? And this small thing is really irrelevant. Well, like, if a guy was so close that he could just start working out, make himself more attractive, dress a little bit better, act more social, and it'll solve 89% of the problems. Meanwhile, you know what I mean? That small sliver of just don't jerk off. And then that one time out of 100, it'll make a difference.
Well, also,
you think that's a fair framing?
I think NoFap is something guys like think they can do. Like, it's something that's actionable, right?
The water bucket challenge.
Yeah. No, okay. So I think that a lot of guys, particularly now, are jerking off more than they ever have before because we have access to it. It's like you said, junk food. Yeah. And what does that in this case, the junk food has the effect of sedating the beta males who get into it. Like I've honestly, as a married guy who's been happily married for a long time, and I've been having sex regularly, really, since I was about 17 years old. You know, that's when I lost my virginity. So, you know, I might have had a dry spell for 6 or 8 months somewhere in between there, but certainly for the last 24, I've had pretty regular sex. So yeah. It's not like I have to, I have to worry about these things. But the thing is that, like, when you do, when that's like your, when that is what's obsessive about you, I should also say this, is that when guys, there are other things that will raise and lower your testosterone. So like victory, like defeating a rival, like beating the shit.
Competition is huge.
Competition will raise your, we've proven, scientifically proven, will raise your testosterone. If your sports team wins the Super Bowl, raising testosterone. Maybe not like crazy, not like TRT, but like, you know, it will raise your testosterone. The idea of the, like, you see a girl who's like, who's sexually available and she's trying to turn you on, raising testosterone. You know what lowers testosterone? Pair bonding. Getting with the girl, marriage, lowers.
Well, that explains it, because guys take a huge testosterone boost when their first child is born.
Right. And then so after that, once you, like, when you are single and then your testosterone is at one level, you will be at a lower level once you have been married for like probably about a year or so. Then after that, if the guys that get divorced, they will test them before the divorce and they'll test them after the divorce. Once they get divorced, guess what happens? Goes right back up.
It's like a girl who loses 60 pounds after the divorce all of a sudden.
Because I think because it's a psychological thing that says, okay, I got to get ready for, you know, reproduction with somebody else. Or maybe it's just the anticipation for it. When, this is going to sound really cruel, but like when a rival alpha kills and defeats another alpha, like primate, let's just say, what that has the effect of doing, or killing the offspring of that rival, it has the effect of sending the female primates into estrus. Mm-hmm. Well, oh man, that's horrible. How could that? Like, humans were like appalled at something like that, but that's how it works, because that
those were the brides that didn't get killed.
Exactly. What
it was selected for.
Yeah. So the only way for them to survive is to bear offspring to the new guy who will protect them, because now it's his kid and he has parental investment in the little baby gorilla.
Yeah, and you didn't say orgasm either. You just said make them wet. That's like, right. People don't understand that the sex, getting wet for sex, and the orgasm, oxytocin, those are two separate things. Mm. Caveman, if you want to be 100% alpha, you literally do what John says, ejaculate, evacuate. A girl getting her nut does not factor in at all.
Zenith has, this is a pretty good one. Thanks, Zenith. He says, these guys don't know how their bodies work. It took me a week of NoFap to resensitize for a date. All right, we'll get to desensitization here in a minute, because I do agree with you on this part. Mm-hmm. The hard part is having a real girl to experiment with and find out what turns you on. Try it out. Yeah, thanks, man. That was good. So, but in a way, he's right, because I think that when guys have been brought up on digital pornography from the time they're maybe 9 or 10 years old, and let's just be straight up honest here. Mm-hmm. Kids that young have access to a degree of sexuality that used to be reserved for like dynastic emperors and Caesar or Caligula, right? That's who got to have that from back in the day. And now it's like hot and cold running water right now. It's part of the utilities. And so a kid with a cell phone can get that anytime that they want to, unless mommy and daddy find some way to sort of prevent that. And guess what? He's going to spend the rest of his time trying to figure out how to get that out, how to get that limitation off of there, because that's what they're going to do. But I 100% agree with a lot of the critics of pornography when it comes to this, is that we have access to it like we've never had access to pornography before. We have access to a level of sexuality that is so ubiquitous, and that's the only word I can use. It's so endemic, it's so overwhelming right now that it changes who we are and what we are as
yeah, but that's everything. Our access to sugar and food is where it's never been before. Our access to drugs, where it's never been before. A guy in the chat made a case. So what you're saying, if a guy does coke once a month, and I'm like, yeah, have you not heard of like casual users? Trying to compare them to addicts is the same way as comparing porn to like sexual addiction.
Right.
There's a huge gray area between a casual user and an addict. And I think addiction is the issue, but people keep latching on to the things that people get addicted to. which is kind of disingenuous.
Hmm. So Andrew says this. He says, refraining from PMO, pornography, masturbation, now you know, just gives me more self-control. Okay. Did you have self-control before you did it, or did you have self-control after you started doing it?
But see, that's the same thing. At least he's addressing the addiction issue. Exactly. If you're jerking it 12 times a day and you stop, then that's generally a good thing.
Right.
At the very least, you've bought a good hour out of your day that you can spend doing something.
And he said, it's not about gaining superpowers and BS. It's about control over your life. Okay. Yeah, it is.
Talk to everybody else doing it then, because they seem to disagree with you.
Let me ask you this. Is the chicken or the egg? Did you need self-control over your life before you ceased, or did you need it at, or was it a result of ceasing?
See, you have an article on this.
You would have to have a sense of control. You'd have to be able to, like I've said this before, it's like you have to change your mind about yourself. And if you want any kind of real change in your life, you want to live the best life you can. It has to. Sorry. I Tony Robbins. I was going to say are the results because you had self-control, or are the results itself self-control? And I would argue that you had to come to a point where you had enough self-control to like cease that so that it did something to you. So again, causation or correlation is what I'm asking. Is it a crisis of motive, basically, is what it is. Why do you do what you do, kind of thing. But this is, he did say this though. I'll put it back up here again really quick. He says, it's not about gaining superpowers. Well, guess what? There are a lot of grifters online who want you to believe that it's all about getting superpowers, because they'll be happy to sell you a 6 or 12 or 20 step program as to how you can do that.
There's even free ones, dude. The semen retention subreddit, twice the size of the Married Red Pill. They promise everything, everything. Okay, this one guy actually said why the Illuminati doesn't want you ejaculating. That's like one of the top posts of all time. I think it's number 3. How literally the powers that be want you to jerk off a lot. Mm-hmm. It's like, dude, we're not talking about the same thing. And you may not believe it as a reasonable guy, but you're essentially carrying water for these psychos.
Right.
I think keep that in mind.
I didn't want to go here today, but I'm just going to go here very, very briefly. I think one of the reasons why a lot of the quote unquote red pill, I don't want to call them red pill, the ethno-nationalists, let's say, IQ guys, one of the reasons why they hate pornography so much is because they think that the Jews are in control of it. And they think that is why, and they won't say it direct. I mean, some of them might say something. They think, oh, it's the Jewish question. It's the JQ because of it. And I'm like, okay. I mean, here's the thing is none of that works unless human sexuality works. None of that works unless oxytocin is dumped into your system. None of that works unless you have testosterone. None of that works regardless of anything. So, you know, they want to say, well, it's a means of control. And feminism was created by the Rockefellers.
Yeah. Carl and I already talked about this. You cannot simultaneously believe that rich, wealthy, powerful people are psychopaths and willing to do anything to get into power, but at the same time have almost a communist level ability to form a cartel amongst each other. Like those two things just don't work.
Mm-hmm.
So I know this is the last thing I'll say on the ethno-nationalists. If you want to have a cabal at the top of things, they're either so evil and psychopathic that they're willing to do whatever it takes to win, or they're a closely knit team. One or the other. Can't be both.
Right. Christian says, again, thanks, Christian. Medical. Said his name right this time. It seems like NoFap was meant to get off porn to go after girls and improve, but all these car video NoFappers don't put in the work, and it's sad. Yeah, that's another thing is if this is what you want to do, and I've said this before, it's like don't jerk off before you go on a date. But you still got to go on the date. Right? You still got to get to that point. I think one of the reasons why guys always, you know, why porn is so endemic for these guys, or it's such a sedation for them, is because it demotivates them from actually going out and having to do anything. Why bother? What's the incentive? Because if you feel like you're hopeless, if you're a doomer, right? If you're a black pill doomer, why, you know, you can hate yourself all day long because you jerk off. But at the end of the day, you can still justify it as being the most pragmatic decision or the most pragmatic way to live your life, because you're non-competitive. You're literally non-competitive. You're not going to go out there and do anything. And the other part is this, is if there is any kernel, any germ of truth to what you're saying about the NoFap sub right there. And you know, it's part of the Illuminati or whatever. again, it doesn't work unless humans are humans. But the thing is like, why, first of all, why? And then second of all, you know, the whole thing comes down to like, what, you know, you have, if you have control over this, maybe it's some way of like fighting back. Like, I'm fighting back by not touching my wiener or something like that. It's like something you can actually do. And again, yeah. It goes back to that actionable thing.
Makes you feel really noble, doesn't it? I'm fighting the powers that be. I am Luke Skywalker. They are against me. Every failure I have is their fault. That's right. Typical of like a narcissistic attitude. Everything is about me except for blame.
Well, the other part is these guys, if that's what your belief is, if you really think it's like the Jews, or you think it's like the cabal of evil, you know, capitalists or whatever, it is, the end result, I like, okay, so let's just say, for put on our tinfoil hats here and just say that that's the way it is. What's the effect of that? What's the effect of you like staying inside all day and jerking it off? Well, it's sedating you. You're just making my point. It's sedating you, so you won't do anything. So you'll be more docile. So you won't rise up against them. So you won't, like, it still goes back to the fact that you are being demotivated by this stuff. You're still being, and I'm not saying it's like, you know, some woo-woo magical thing. It's a behavioral thing. It's a biochemical thing. So when you have, when we're talking about the emotionality that comes from it, or the sedation that comes from it, yeah, it demotivates you because you're not out there learning how to code because you're trying to get a girlfriend. Why would I you want to know why guys are dropping out of college and don't really care? And, you know, we always talk about the Lost Boys, Jen. I've talked about this forever. Is there a generation of guys who are the audience for a guy like Jordan Peterson? Or
what end are they running this hamster wheel of college and university and all this stuff? That's the point.
Mm-hmm.
You know who did a great thing on this? Actually, Thomas Barnett, a geostrategic analyst. He mentioned it in reference to the Arab Spring, but I think it plays equally well here.
I think I know where you're going to go. I actually think I quoted this at one point, but go ahead.
I wouldn't be surprised. Yeah, as a man, you want to have a family and you want to have children. Now, when that's prevented to a certain extent and desperation gets hard, that's how revolutions happen. That guy who lit himself on fire, that first start of the Arab Spring, what happened? He went to college. He went to college because that would get him a good job. The good job would get him a girl. Girl would get him kids. The good job never came. And so all he did is he left 4 years later more pissed off. And then he was working hard. He's like, all right, I still believe. And what it finally did that did him in, a female bylaw officer knocked over his cart of fruit. That was his only last remaining hope of living that life with a family that he wanted. And all he could do, and this is the part where I really don't like PowerPoint MGTOWs for that, instead of lashing out at the world, he lights himself on fire. Like, talk about making the ultimate point of male impotence. Lashing out. Can't even kill anybody else. He has to kill himself. And yeah, there was enough frustration that, you know, set the whole Middle East on fire.
I mean, that was the Arab Spring in what, 2013, 2014, something?
Yeah.
Like that? Yeah. So I actually wrote about that, and about how, and I just recalled those posts because of what's going on here in the US and actually other places too. I said this in March. I have a tweet somewhere saying that this is the beginning of the American Spring or the American Summer, right? Because here you have a huge population of 18 to 24 year olds, 18 to 29 year olds, who the GSS study just months before said, these guys aren't getting laid. 8 times less sex than the previous generation before. The girls are still having sex, but the guys are not having sex. And granted, we have a different culture here. You can still get pornography and get off. You can still reproduce in the United States without being married, right? I mean, for better or worse, that's simply the state.
You can eat oatmeal every day, but that's not going to help people.
Right. But these guys, it doesn't relieve the sexual frustration. It doesn't relieve the incentive. I don't want to call it energy, because everybody will take that to mean like, oh, you mean energy? Like, you know, the secret, you know?
Yeah, like, sort of like that.
Action? No, that's not what I mean. I mean incentive. I mean angst. I mean the kind of stuff that you redirect that sexual frustration to something else. Well, guess what we're doing? Guess what the 18 to 29 year olds are doing right now in the streets? They're redirecting it to something else, just like they did in the Arab Spring. Now, the Arab Spring, I think, was a little bit different because you have a culture that is based on polygamy. So
there's just not enough girls to go around.
Right. If you're Abu American and you've got three wives, that means three other dudes don't have a wife.
And those guys were there for conquest. That was bodies for the meat grinder.
and they will never find a way to, and I realize, Muslim brothers, that it is not a requisite, it's an option, but it's still an option. And that's how I was at The Economist did a story back in, I think, 2016, 2017, mm-hmm. about how polygamous cultures tend to be more war-torn, financially, you know, devastated. They tend to be countries just like the countries in the Arab Spring, right? Because there is that sexual angst. If you know that you cannot get a wife because your neighbor has four of them, what are you going
to
do?
Existential despair and nihilism, lashing out at the world in order to get it. Because whatever comes out of that fire has to be better than this slow death you're having now. That's generally the attitude.
Mm-hmm. Right. So, and so I see a parallels to that, let's say. I don't think it's exactly like that in the U.S. right now, because we have other options, I guess. But I think that guys who are out there doing what they're doing, I mean, what if you go and you look at, like, when the riots first started happening in May and in June, you saw girls out there just taking selfies and putting pictures of themselves up on, you know, hey, here I am in the burning building. Oh, look, Starbucks is on fire. You know, that was the motivation, was to go out there because it was a social event and it was something that you could do. You know, again, is it boredom? Is it just angst? Is it just frustration? Yeah, maybe it's a lot of all of that, but guess what? You're motivated. You're doing something. You're out there. If you're not at home spanking the monkey, what are you doing with the energy? And that's what Dorian here said. When it's all said and done, if you do practice semen retention, then what are you going to create with your will in reality you live?
Yeah.
You're not going to get a badge nor panties with that opening line.
That's purpose. That's what he's talking about. Same as your article. If it wasn't Xbox, it'd be something else. You're just replacing jerking off with jerking off about not jerking off or retaining your semen. And everybody's like, oh, but what about Tesla? Tesla, last 15 years of his life, had no discernible product at all. So don't tell me how Tesla was the greatest guy ever. He had one thing and then spent a lifetime doing nothing.
Nothing else. Yeah. Well, I've talked to guys who talk to me about, like, monk mode, or they'll say, I'm MGTOW and I'm just not making women the measurement of my life anymore. If they want to come over here and suck this, I'm all about it. But if not, I'm going to go do what I'm going to do. Okay. So what are you doing? Can I go over to your house and see your workshop and see all the great new inventions you come up with, Mr. Nick? No, it's not there. They're just all it is just simply just, you know, either going along to get along, or, you know, I don't see any cures for cancer coming from that side. Honestly, I think that most of human civilization, a lot of the advances that we have, are a direct result of beta males trying to find some end around to solve the reproductive problem.
Now, and they invented the dishwasher. Now she's got some free time.
You need to do them too.
Okay.
Every guy that finds a new designer drug, what's he do? He goes to the club with it and offers it to Stacy.
Right. And I mentioned this in, well, I think I had a show. I had an essay about transactional versus validational sex. If your only frame of reference when it comes to sex is is transactional sex, that's for betas, more or less, because that's what beta male primates do. Is they, here's the banana. Here, I'm going to give you a banana. You fuck me, okay? I'm going to pick the nits off of you, and we're going to have sex. I'm going to take care of the alpha's child, and then when you're back, then can I? You know, that's the
sex minus the dopamine.
It's all
oxytocin.
And I shouldn't just pick on primates or picking on primates.
Stupid monkeys.
No, I mean, every, like, higher order mammal does that. There's a transaction to, I mean, you know, birds will pick the male bird that makes the shiniest nest. That's the exchange that's going between the two of them. You know, hey, give me some of that and I'll give you some of this. That's really what it comes down to. Well, in transactional sex, that's really beta male sex, is that how do I solve my reproductive problem? I'm not the alpha. I've got to find a way around it, because if I don't, then I don't pass my genes on to the next generation. Okay, let's build a great big cathedral. Let's code the next, you know, BioWare thing. Let's go, you know, do.
And if you're the Pope, you need a whole army. So you're going to basically create social constraints to allow this to happen.
Right.
Encourage the beta male sex, because that's the most productive sector of your society.
If you cannot reproduce via alpha seed, then reproduce via beta need. And the problem now is that women don't need the betas anymore. That's the whole thing.
The betas automated their process. Exactly. It's all done.
And so in that society, in a gynocentric society, pornography is really the sedation that's needed for those guys while women enjoy the benefits of technology and all the stuff that has happened up to this point, and they don't need those guys. I mean, figuratively, they don't need those guys. I mean, there's other reasons why they might need those guys, but not certainly not when they're at their peak of sexuality, their peak sexual market value years. Yep. So it's like if the perception, even if it's perceptual, it doesn't have to be real. Even if a woman says, well, you know what? All that long-term security stuff is already pretty much made for me because I'm a mature woman of the 2020s and I have a job and I'm a careerist and everything else. And I can provide for myself. I can provide for my whatever family I might have.
Yeah, she's in debt, but all she knows is that every month new Abbeys are coming in on Tuesdays.
Exactly. And so, yeah, maybe OnlyFans girl. But she wants to get with the hot guys. She's not banging the guys that are paying her exorbitant amount of money being her orbiters. Whether that's direct or indirectly, she wants to get guys because she doesn't have to.
I make the case actually that we're the last luxury good. And that's how you kind of have to brand yourself as a man now. Like your provision doesn't count for nothing. You can't bring home the bacon. Bacon costs $3 at the store and she already earns $1.08 per every dollar if you technically look at the numbers. So all that's left is the alpha stuff, that dopamine hit. Oxytocin is handled.
Asan Haji, I said your name right this time, dude. Mohammed says, is not NoFap a part of Up the Alpha?
What? Who says this?
It makes you more into game. Well, there's the motivational. I've been saying that the whole thing. There's the motivational aspect of like not jerking off. Like it will motivate you to novel behaviors that will get you to having sex.
So. Here's the thing, though. That's different. You said not jerking off. That's not NoFap trademark. Mm-hmm. See the difference, though, between branding it, making it something that you can invest your ego into, as opposed to just, yeah, just in order to have more sex, I got to stop touching my dick and get out there and approach. One of it just makes it a matter of fact thing that you just do. The other one makes it an ego invested brand. It's a marketing gimmick. And now if you're attached to this brand, anything NoFap is associated with my identity. And that's not the same thing. I don't think even close.
Well, yeah. And it becomes an identifier. Mm-hmm. It's like it becomes ego invested. So if you attack it, if you in any way, like even just critically analyze it, then it's like, well, it worked for me. It's like, you're right. It's a religious experience for them.
Yep. Something. And don't say you don't understand either, because incel is a thing now, guys. So you know people do this. They're branding themselves based on not being attractive right now. Nobody wants to do that until they make it a brand.
Oh. Let me back up a little bit here. Amar came back in and he said, I cured my porn induced erectile dysfunction. That's what I wanted to get to next. By refraining to watch and follow up with NoFap, PhD in physics. Yeah. Because of it. Because he did.
Hey, how much were you touching your dick that you can get a PhD now?
Yeah. Big particle because I have NoFap. let's see. And not taken by beliefs, but facts. Okay. Well, here's, I understand the desensitization of it. So if all you've ever known about sex is you learned through pornography, then yeah, I can see that. Like a lot of guys report this, and I don't think that this, I haven't found any studies that have proved it otherwise, but guys who are quote unquote addicted to pornography have trouble getting it up for their wives when the time comes, right? They have trouble with sexual function this is what they report. I don't know if this is like how widespread this is or whatever, but it makes sense and from a sort of a reasonable rational side, because you know, like when we watch a horror movie, we still kind of experience that rush of fear that we don't actually get all that much in our, that we used to get quite a bit when we were living in the tribes, you know, in the Serengeti, right?
Right.
But we don't get that anymore. And one of the reasons I think anyways, why like suspense and horror and scary Alien, right? Why is that a scary movie? Because we want to experience that, but we're experiencing it sort of like, you know, behind the wall sort of thing. Like we know it's safe. Same thing with pornography is I think most guys realize that they will probably never in their lifetime experience the same kind of sex that they're seeing on screen. And so it's sort of like living
just totally unfortunate and tragic.
Right. But if you watch it long enough, That's the only thing that triggers that. Now, I've said this, is that we have natural proclivities. We have things that we're born with because it's our firmware, right? We have our hardware, our firmware, and our software. Sometimes the software can override the firmware. So while the firmware is, if you see a half-naked chick on the cover of Sports Illustrated, you know, she's in a bikini, you're going to get aroused by that, and you're going to have thoughts of wanting to, you know, wanting to reproduce with her, like look at her as an object. It's going to trigger the part in your brain about tool use. Mm-hmm. Those things exist for an evolutionary reason. That's why those work. That was your firmware. You can watch too much porn and look at a girl on the Sports Illustrated swimsuit edition. Of course, she's probably looks like, you know, morbidly obese now, but let's just say for sake of argument, this one looks good. Okay. You're not going to be as thrilled by that girl as the sex that you just saw. Anytime, anywhere, any play, like you just call it up on your phone right then and there while you're looking at the magazine, if you wanted to, you have that ability. But the thing is the software, what you're learning from pornography is rewriting, or, oh, I should say rewrite. It's overwriting your natural firmware, your natural arousal impulse as a result of that. You can also say the same thing for food. You can say the same thing for like horror movies.
Oh yeah. Stuff. If you're starving, you'll kill somebody for a sandwich.
Right.
But
right.
And I'll buy this too. Like I used to sail when I was first dating my girl, I'd go off on a 2-week sail, just like a little booze cruise, and then come back. Mm-hmm. Sex was hot and heavy at that point. She'd show up to my place in a trench coat and nothing else. Mm-hmm. So I get it. I wouldn't call that semen retention. I just called that work.
Right. So
maybe right. That's why I'm just not putting enough importance on it. Mm-hmm. Maybe that's what I need to do. Have my course. How to join the military, sail for 2 weeks at a time. There's your semen retention program, and you get paid by the queen.
So then I'm looking at some of these other ones. So there's that. I think that there is definitely some correlation to watching too much porn. Mm-hmm. Have it influence your arousal process. And then, of course, once you sort of push that off and you don't watch porn anymore, you're more turned on by the real thing. Unless the real thing is what's really sort of the cause of the problem,
with nagging,
solve with the pornography. And I'm going to be very, very unpopular when I say this, but I'm going to say it anyways. I put this on Twitter. I believe that pornography has saved and perpetuated more marriages than it has ever destroyed.
Oh, guaranteed.
And people do not like it when I say that because it's a smack in the face. Like, oh, it's horrible. Like women hate when I say that, but it's true.
Because you're calling them fat.
Well, yeah, essentially, exactly. Pretty much
fat, and you nag too much, lady.
Why is the guy into it in the first place? Well, he's looking for something that he's not getting in the bedroom. Either it's because he's too timid, or because that's not the relationship you had, or it's a religious thing, or it's whatever. Okay. Or maybe, oh, he just grew up that way. Well, okay, you can even make that as an argument. The fact of the matter is that the fantasy, the immersive fantasy of whatever he's escaping into, and in this case, it's a sexual escape, is preferable to what he's getting at home, to the real thing that he's getting in the bedroom.
Well, that was my question to you.
Maggie, yeah.
Yeah, I would suggest find me a guy who has sexual options with attractive women who's addicted to porn, and I have never heard of one before.
Yeah, yeah. The guys that, the guy, I read this, I think when I told Sterling this, I read this article. I actually read an article in a Playboy magazine one time. It was I read it because they was doing an interview of Bret Michaels from Poison, the lead singer from Poison.
Was he the one with the sex tape with, oh no, that's not Pam Anderson.
He's probably
one.
Got several of them. No, you're thinking of Vince Neil with
that's Pam. The one.
No, he might have one with Pamela. Everybody else does, right? Remember when a sex tape was a big deal?
Oh yeah. It was a big deal, and then it became like a career move. Now it's just like, oh, another one, whatever. The fappening kind of ruined that. Yeah. Now everybody's sex tapes out. You're like, you're into a girl when she doesn't have one.
Whatever. Oh, but he said this, like they asked, one of the interview questions was, how many times have you had sex in the same day, in the same 24-hour period? And he thought about it for a second, and he said 8. And then I went home and jerked off afterwards. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, that's... If you are, you know, if that's who you are, if you're alpha male and you have those opportunities and you have women all the time, you know, you still have a libido, right? But
yeah.
Yeah. I mean,
sometimes it's a convenience thing. You just got 10 minutes to kill and you got to get the urge out of your system, whatever. But the options, that's the difference.
Well, and I think that a lot of guys, we have told guys, you know, in the past anyways, I don't think we do this anymore, but certainly we're maybe right up until like maybe the late 80s, early 90s, was a guy had to get it out of his system. right? Oh, you go and sow your wild oats and then settle down with a good old homie girl from the country. You know, that then you can have kids and babies and live happily ever after. And so we kind of thought about that in terms of guys who are sort of restless. Those are the guys who actually could experience that. They actually had the either physical way of doing it, or they had a good game, or maybe both, some kind of charm, whatever. Mm-hmm. They were lucky with the ladies, right? So their notch count was going to be high, and there was going to be the other guys. Ooh, maybe they get a couple of girlfriends, maybe three, and then they settle down. So those are we still kind of think of guys as sort of the dogs, right? They're the ones who just like they're the ones that cheat the most, right? They're the ones that jerk off the most. They're the ones that should be. We only really hold men accountable for sexual indiscretions. We rarely care. And today, I think we'll see an increase of this in the future. But certainly not to the same degree. Like when you look at like Brett Kavanaugh, who is this Supreme Court justice that was getting sort of me too'd, like,
back, oh yeah, that was brutal to watch.
It will go back. I mean, that's, you want to know why there's no statute of limitations to me too. That's why, because we only go after men. Yep. And so we need to be able to go after them when they pulled Susie's pigtails when he was like 9 years old in grammar school. And that's enough to say, oh, well, you are sexually harassing her and therefore you should not have this job or do whatever.
I want to preface this, by the way. We're not saying Cosby giving them Quaaludes and doing them in their sleep is the same thing here. We're not going down that road. Sorry, please continue.
I hate that we have to like do that too. But yeah, again, this is not because I said that. Doesn't mean go out there and rape all those girls. It's okay. That's not what I'm saying.
Jesus.
I know. Zenith here. I'm trying to catch up a little bit. Zenith here says, porn can't beat millions of years of evolution. Find out how long it takes to resensitize and you'll have no problem on a date.
Sure.
Yeah. Again, Zenith, that's what I was saying, is there's the hardware, the firmware, and the software. So yeah, when the software is overriding those things, then yeah, you can get back to that. In some ways, like people think that that's either that's a good thing or a bad thing. It's not always a bad thing. It's good to learn martial arts because generally we don't want to get punched in the face and we run away.
Yep. I mean,
sometimes you have to fight and you have to learn how to fight.
Or at least look like you can fight, because that way people don't mess with you as much.
We train you to do that, or like we train you to turn into a skid, right? Instead of with the skid, or slam the brakes on so you kill yourself. All of your instinct, all of your hardware and your firmware wants to stop the car. But if you slam on the brakes while you're in a skid, you'll go into a turn and it'd be worse and you'll probably die. But if you turn into, you're taught by software to turn into the skid and override the firmware, guess what? You live, you know, you learn these things so you can override certain things. There's advantages and disadvantages for that.
I would argue though, when he's saying that we can't overcome our DNA, I'd argue obesity is a perfect example of how we do. Our software has overridden the hardware.
Right.
Because you'd have to chew on sugarcane for an hour to get a little bit of carbs to allow you to have the energy to hunt. Now we've condensed it to a sugar cube and people are eating it to the point that their instincts are actually making them sick. I'd argue porn, kind of a similar phenomenon to that, maybe not as extreme, maybe somewhat more extreme, but again, you kind of have to go against your instincts here, but you don't want to dial the tism up to 12 and turn it into a religious experience. Cause like I don't even know how to end this thought other than you just have to pay attention to what comes out the other end. The outcomes make all the difference because it's just too safe and we can believe in nonsense and we won't die from it. So we have no incentives to make us believe anything worthwhile or objectively good because there's no pain on the other side of it. None of these semen retention guys will die. None of them. So why would they not believe it?
Tempest says a semen retention. The Ryan Stone, sorry. and then Scott Summers here from the X-Men, apparently. Cyclops, thank you very much. Roosh is actually red pilled. The Jewish question is real and last red pill.
Okay. Speaking of jerking off.
Thanks. Yeah, we got it. There's your $4.99, brother.
Dude, the only difference between him and the Unabomber is the Unabomber was really good at math.
Yeah. And his mom didn't live upstairs. sorry. So the last thing I wanted to get to that's on my list here is sort of the woo-woo magical thinking that goes along with this, because I think that a good portion of semen retention goes to sort of like this shamanism guru kind of, and it's not, I shouldn't just say it's like sort of these tribal religions. It's also like very much in Catholic religion, like don't touch yourself. Why would it be a sin Like, even if it's a venial sin, I guess one of the lower grade crimes, right? Why would it be a sin for a guy at all? Now, because when we think of masturbation, I don't think we really even think women actually do it, but I mean, clearly they do, but
yeah, a lot less, but they do.
Historically, we have made masturbation a sin for guys. And there has to be some sort of like social, I think there has to be some sort of social mechanism or some latent purpose as to why that would be a thing. And I think
guilt and control myself. What do you think?
It's easier to control. And that's what I was going to get at is if I can control you through superstition, if I can control you through like magical thinking, what's the easiest trigger in guys? It's your sexuality, because it's always on. So if you are in any way expressing, like men are not, especially now, are never allowed to express themselves sexually except within certain frameworks or certain zones. And now we've sort of loosened those things up. But what we do is we weaponize the restrictions that we place on those guys. So like I would argue that Me Too is one of those weaponized restrictions. So we can go back to when you were, 10 years old and pulling Susie's pigtails and call that sexual harassment now. That's one of the weaponizations. Another one might be like, don't touch yourself or you go blind.
I remember that one.
Or what is it? Onanism, I think. if you spill the seed, then God's going to send you to hell, kind of thing. And I've looked at those things as, again, that's software. Right? It's the religion and learning these things is software that's overriding the firmware. And the firmware is, I want to get laid and I want to use, but we can't have all these beta males going out there and expressing themselves. We're walking around, like walking around with a hard on all the time. We've got to find some way to sort of keep them under control, but still keep them productive. And I think we've kind of, maybe that's what happened like throughout the, throughout
well, prior history. To the Industrial Revolution. Yeah, essentially.
Exactly. And agrarianism. That's another thing I don't think people really realize is that there, once we moved past sort of like hunter gatherer, for lack of a better term, because I know there's civilization after that, but hunter gatherer type societies where polygamy or polygyny was, was accepted, right? I mean, mm-hmm. Father Abraham had Sarah and another wife and God knows how many concubines and started the tribes of Israel. There's your Jewish question for today. and did all that because that was what was acceptable then. And even now today in Muslim culture, polygyny is still acceptable. And
I think Mormons had it too for the, like, they just ended it, what, 20, 30 years ago, maybe a generation.
But then there was a shift, and people want to say that this is because of agrarianism that we shifted over to monogamy. And monogamy, I think, is really was the compromise, because that was what served the most beta males.
Yep.
You're going to get, okay, guys, don't worry. Just don't touch yourself. Just serve the church. Just go build a cathedral. Go work your farm. Here's your wife. You'll get a wife and you get children.
Okay. Yep. One wife, go to work.
Thank God I'm going to have sex. That's okay, good. And if that wasn't the case, then you would go join the monasteries, and then you'd find out another end around your sexual.
Or they'd promise you, women, go to war. What, the guys that come back, there'll be more women for you.
That was the other one. Yeah. So there's the agrarian argument, and then there was the war argument. And I think that this was more of like a Islam thing, wasn't it? Because the guys who would go out to war, there wouldn't be enough guys coming back to repopulate or replenish the population, I guess, of whatever that church was, or like, I mean, in certain religions, certainly in Catholicism, it's like, have as many babies as you can, have
it. We need more Catholics.
Yeah. We need more Catholics. Same thing with Islam, have as many babies as possible. You need four wives to even make it exponentially bigger. Here you go.
Even in the States, the Quakers, the Fundies. In fact, I can't remember, somebody's making an argument today how they were, because they were born in the time of the Industrial Revolution, it was actually the most successful example of that we have in history, because, maybe six kids, one of them might have died of cholera in the 1860s, but now it's just free form, population just booming, and these groups are having more babies than everybody, and nobody's dying off because there's no war. World War II decimated Europe, but North America was largely absent from it.
Mm-hmm.
So now that's why you have a devoutly religious America, because you guys just had a good 100 years to just keep, pumping out the kids.
Mm-hmm. So I've heard this before. Now this actually kind of dovetails into what we're talking about. Let me take that off, because I gotta segue into this. When I was doing research for book four, I was going back to like all the way back to like 2005 and looking at some old videos of like pastors and preachers. And it's not just, I mean, this is largely a Western Christian thing, but it's not just those guys. But even in church sermons, it's always the addiction thing. Whenever we're talking about addiction or men need to do better, I've talked about this on with Dalrock tons of times. Like if you go to Father's Day sermons, it's always, well, man, you need to, you suck and you need to do better. And it's usually you need to break those addictions. And from 2005 on up to 2020, it became less about alcohol and became almost exclusively about pornography. Like I said, 68% of evangelical men report that they are addicted to pornography.
Oh yeah, I remember it used to be gambling and booze. Yeah, that just kind of disappeared one day. You're right.
Well, and let's think about that for a second, because and you could sort of apply this to Catholics. You certainly could. I know it's haram for Muslim men. Mm-hmm. I don't know how Jews sort of see this, but I can imagine there's something similar. And you know, Hindus, whatever else. Hindus tend to be more sexual, like they're more sexually permissive than anything. But even still, when you're taught according to your conviction and the software that's sort of changing your mind about how things ought to be in the universe, I guess, when you're taught that you should save yourself for marriage, premarital sex, especially in anything that's sort of post 1970 around there, asking a guy to stay celibate and stay a virgin until what most likely is going to be, you know, most men have today, they get married at like the average age of
economic surplus when you can afford to have a dependent, essentially.
You're going to ask the average guy to abstain from sex until the average age of 29. And then he gets to have sex with his wife, who in all likelihood is probably in her epiphany phase at that stage. But let's just say for sake of argument, she does the same thing. And then you're going to throw that guy into a society where online streaming ubiquitous 4K porn is freely available. And he's going to look at that. Do you think he's going to go, not for me kind of thing? Or do you think he's going to go,
he's set up for failure.
He's exactly set up for failure. So he's going to see that and he's going to go, I'm not getting three ways. She won't gobble the goo. Why is it, you know, how I thought I was getting her sexual best. I waited all this time so that I could have, you know, the wild, hot, fun, acrobatic monkey sex stuff. How come she's not into me as much as it's the transactional thing. But when it's your conviction and you mix that in with sort of blue pill conditioning as well and defer to the wife. And if she's not happy with you, then God's not happy with you. And therefore you've got to find some way to sort of, you've got to crush and kill your pornographic addictions, because now it's an addiction.
Yeah.
And I've seen the study, and people are going to probably quote this, so I'm just going to go and run it out. There's a lot of guys are going to say, like, well, what about like that? What is it? X Church or something? There's like some sort of organization.
You always got to find some crazy extreme outlier to make a point.
And you know what? As long as that's something that's in your head, as long as that's something that's sort of a superstition for, I don't say superstition is the only word I can use, but as long as that's some like your conviction, let's just say, there's going to be guys and girls who are going to be right there ready to make money off of it. And
oh, that's guaranteed.
What they're doing right now. And you don't even have to be like a part of organized religion. If it's sort of your woo-woo magical thinking that you should stop doing pornography or you should stop jerking, whatever, semen retention, it makes me I'm sending out positive juju into the universe because I'm not jerking off. Okay. But there's going to be guys who are going to see that and use that. That's a thumbscrew, right? Yeah.
It's emergent strategy is what it is. Hmm? It doesn't have to be a cabal of people talking about jerk off stuff. Marketers are going to try to market everything. And as soon as something gets some traction, guys will see other guys working it. And then they will basically jump onto the grift.
Yeah.
So people just notice it.
I'm not saying, again, and I have to keep repeating this. I'm not saying, keep going jerking off. If you think it's a problem, if it's getting in the way from like you doing like work or doing whatever, you know, living a life that motivates you to do things beyond just jerking off all the time. It's the same thing as like, you know, stop drinking, stop doing heroin, you know, stop.
That's the thing. Stop drinking. That's an action. Not become a an alcoholic anonymous, a non guy, a temperance guy. Don't make it part of your identity. It's just a thing you do to achieve a result that you want. In this case, I want to drink less. I want to have more sex and I want to get my hand off my dick long enough to get a PhD.
Well, I mean, everybody knows that I worked in alcohol for almost 13, 14 years now.
Evil man.
I have not had
bootlegger.
I have not had a drink since 2017, since December of 2017. And I'll tell you why I did that. Not because I had a problem with it. It was because I thought, you know what? I want to focus 100% on my writing. I want to focus 100% on doing what I'm doing, right? I want to be Rollo Tomasi. I want to write a good, this is when I decided to write book four, right? And so I'm looking at this, I'm going, I can't do that. I don't want to be hungover. I don't want to be whatever. I just want to focus on one thing. And I was,
so you don't even do like the table wine with dinner, like nothing, no Irishing your coffee in the morning.
I just turned it off, and that was, and I felt better for it because I'm not like having to wake up and recover because I had something to drink when I was doing a promo or something. I'm around it all the time. I'm still to this day, I'm around it all the time. But I was just like, you know what? I'm a more efficient human being. I'm a better writer. I'm a better performer, I guess. I'm a better speaker. I'm whatever, because I'm focused on one thing, and I'm not going, I can't make it because I'm got to, you know, sleep in extra this day or whatever. And it wasn't so much a problem thing. It was, I want to be a more efficient person.
You had something better to do.
I had something better to do. And so, and you know what, because I had something better to do, it made it that much easier to just say, I'm done. It's okay. You know?
That was exactly like me with legalizing weed up here. When I first left the military, I'm like, screw it. I'm going to do weed now because, you know, the queen can't tell me what to do. I tried it, put me to sleep. I'm like, it's okay. But then they made it legal like the next month, and I'm like, I'm over it.
Yeah.
Just over it. Whatever.
So if quitting pornography makes you a better human being, or makes you a more motivated person, or you can focus on other things as a result of that, fine. That doesn't mean don't go have sex. That doesn't mean, it not even really means, you know, don't jerk off, but it means, you know, if that's what's impeding you, then get it out of your life. And, but here's, do something with it. Like most guys are just like, oh, I'm here. And they're like white knuckling it for the rest of their lives. Like, oh, I don't know. I can just go click on this window and just check.
Yeah. See. Well, that's the thing. They're not treating it as a means to an end. They're treating semen retention as the end in and of itself. And I think that's the dangerous part.
I need your opinion on this one. So this is MR comes up here, and this is like, and he said, MRI, I know what MRIs are. Thank you. Studies of porn addicts show the same physical brain changes as a drug addict. Respect for the panel.
When they say some studies, that tells me he hasn't read the studies and he just heard somebody say some studies.
You're right.
But I mean, addiction most likely does resonate as addiction, regardless if it's porn or booze or whatever. So I can buy it.
On X Church, I've seen guys like put out like brain scans, and this is the brain scan of a guy who is jerking off for, you know, X amount of years. And this is a guy who's not. And it's like, you can go and show me brain scans of like an alcoholic brain versus a non-alcoholic brain and tell me they're the same thing. And I will go, yeah, looks good. Yeah. Okay. I don't know. I'm not a neurologist. I wouldn't be able to tell you the difference between the two.
Well, that's the thing. Yeah. And developmental, like when a person's an alcoholic at 13, yeah, that'll change the brain because the brain's still developing. Mm-hmm. But I would have a hard time having somebody tell me that during a brain when it's largely plastic, like what, 25 is when it's pretty much firmly set, being able to change it in any significant way based on any addiction at all, unless it's physically destroying the brain. Like, what's that one drug? Crocodile. I don't know if you've heard of that one.
Yes, yes. And like the Russians were taking it and like eats up part of your face or something.
Exactly. Short of that though, I just don't see it.
So I don't know. Like a lot of people will say this. I'll see some studies that are very similar. And again, the topic is different. Like they'll say like, well, if you know, a liberal brain is more defective than a conservative brain or vice versa, whoever happens to be the one.
It's never the guys like my political party's got brain damage. Never hear that.
Well, that's funny because all the guys who want to tell me about like IQ, you know, this and that. And it's like, well, if that's the case, then why would it be any different? Like your intelligence is this and your intelligence is that. Well, it's because your IQ leads you to your political beliefs. You know, there's a lot.
I wish it was so simple. I really do.
It's not just nature and nurture. Well, it's not just nature or nurture. It's both of them together. So
epigenetics, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, because that's the thing. Some things manifest due to certain pressures. Well, what was that study? They had it in Poland based on there was a famine there during the Second World War. And the kids born during that time had a propensity for obesity or a propensity for malnourishment or like a height difference? But there was a physiological change, even though the genes hadn't changed, just because it was expressed a certain way during the developmental period. But again, we're talking about like people in utero. We're not talking about a 19-year-old that can't keep his hand off his dick. And I don't think you can make the argument that one thing correlates to another in there at all.
So I think it also comes back to what the difference between sort of social conditioning or social constructionism versus sort of like biological determinism. There's always that the balance between, well, you learn that. And I think we have almost an exclusive, grossly overemphasized social constructionism right now, because it's the leftist sort of ideology, but it's also can serve, conservative side of things too, but it's primarily mostly, we all choose our own gender, and the only reason you think of beauty standards is a great one, right? The only reason you get off on that is because you've been taught to do whatever.
Yeah, it's always fatties arguing for Hayes. It's always conservatives arguing for God is IQ. It's always whatever you are. I don't think anybody knows or cares about the argument. I think they're just treating it as a cudgel to smash over somebody else's head and to galvanize their flock, for lack of a better word. I really don't think anybody cares.
I remember, and I'll continue. I'll get to the last of these supers here in just a second. But I can remember, because we're at 2 hours right now. I can remember when, like I said, I was looking at the sermons and all the, whenever we're talking about addiction, it's for Christian men, anyways, it's almost always about pornography. Mm-hmm. I can remember back in the day when guys would say, pastors or youth pastors would like come up to me or to whoever else, and they go, this is the month when the swimsuit edition of the Sports Illustrated comes out, and you guys, I just want to let you know, make sure you avert your eyes or whatever, like you shouldn't be looking at it. They were very upset that there was a swimsuit edition and it was going to be on the shelves and you might pass it in the grocery store or something.
Yeah, like, Pastor, how do you know the date it comes out? Just asking for a friend.
I heard about it. Yeah, I'm into sports and they told me that it was coming out. but they're used to, that was the level of sort of control. And now I think it's spun so far out of control that we can make, it's no longer about prevention as it is about like cure. Right. Don't do that. Don't go there. Don't look at the it seems so like silly right now. Right. Don't look
it's
at
like the late adolescence is what it sounds
don't look
like
at Tyra Banks on the cover of the, in her swimsuit and in the bikini kind of thing.
No. Yeah. Apologies for that. We're just seeing if the dogs ate.
That's okay. that seems kind of quaint right now, but the same energy sort of is percolating, I think, in this generation, with the NoFap thing, with the guys who are selling you the latest program on how not to touch yourself anymore. And maybe you're doing it because you think you have some sort of, if this is you anyways, whoever's listening to this, if you think that you have some sort of problem with it and somebody wants to sell you the cure to it, you have to remember, like, first of all, why is this so popular right now? Why are these coming out right now? And like I said, Pinnacle of a Man and Ed Lattimore, and who I have a lot of respect for. I love Ed Lattimore, but man, like this is, and I would expect to see some more of this. And the reason why I think you're going to see more of this is because of COVID.
People are at home with nothing to do. Home. Yeah. I couldn't believe I didn't see it until you said it.
Yeah. So I think that what's one of the this always comes around at least once a year, usually around November. It's like NoFap November or whatever it is, or Movember ends up being NoFap November. And
grow a mustache, don't touch your dick.
Yeah. And so there's always it's always plays well to a certain audience that has sort of a lot of angst, I think, about the fact that they're, if you're jerking off 3 times a day, yeah, you might have a problem. Okay. But if you're jerking off like once a week, you're a dude.
Yeah,
okay.
Let it go.
I would say be very wary of that, because like when back in the day when it was sort of this moralistic thing from churches and everything else, it's again, I think it's that control, certainly a control to keep you sort of on the reservation sort of thing. But I think a lot of guys think that if they avert their eyes from the Sports Illustrated swimsuit cover, or they take it one step further and they want to find a way to ban it from the grocery store, that their wives or their girlfriends or the girls that might be their wives or girlfriends are going to appreciate that and go, oh, my hero, thank you, I could never compete with Tyra.
Hope she sees it, bro.
It's like that kind of like virtue signaling game.
Sneaky fucker strategy.
Sneaky fucker strategy, exactly. Let me give you one last eye. Eugene Morgan says, I've been halfway paying attention because what the heck is this crap? Retention? No, man, we need to bust a nut. That's why wet dreams are a thing. I know. Whenever,
see, I like that, though. He's very healthily looking at the problem.
Whenever I have Sterling Cooper on, which I did on Sunday, everybody's like, so you're promoting pornography? I'm like, no, we're not
even talking pornographers.
Pornographer? No. But yeah. And he actually referred to himself as a prostitute. He's like, technically what I do, well, it's prostitution. It's just, you know, it is what it is. If it meets the definition for it, put it that way. I get
fair enough. Sex.
And then let's see, Zeboristan says, moved in with my girlfriend, read your book. Now I hate living with her, as I feel, her benefactor, like your support. Is there a way to move out again without breaking up?
Yeah. I mean, you're not going to have a choice in that matter. Cause breaking up is not a mutually agreed upon situation. Just live the life you want to live. And then whatever happens, happens. If you don't have that kind of abundance or outcome independence, then you're basically just still a nice guy.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of guys are horrible at that, where they're like, how can I do this thing I want to do without hurting my girl's feelings? I'm like, well, if you're not willing to hurt her feelings, then you don't want it. Mm-hmm. Just flat out, period. And you either need to learn to accept, I don't want it, and live with what's here, or decide that I want it enough that if she leaves me, I want it that bad, at least.
Whose name is the lease in? That's my first question.
Who?
The lease. The lease on. You know, who has their name on the lease?
Like, well, there's logistical issues for sure.
You just go. You know, and then I don't know. At some point you can do so. I don't know. Are you in control of your life or are you not in control of your life?
That's the key point, right? What's power to a guy if not freedom?
FAP is a waste of energy, sex, energies.
I asked these guys to define energy. Nobody gives me a good answer.
An exchange of energy.
What's your energy?
You tired and lazy sex. And lazy sex doesn't. FAP makes you tired. I would say that pretty much orgasm will make you tired, because that's the effect of, especially in guys, for oxytocin.
Yeah. Heck, how many times have you been woken up by your significant other? She can't sleep and she tries to smash a little bit so you guys can get some bed.
I love the Coomer meme, by the way. I think that is probably my favorite meme from 2017, actually.
I love the body count chick, the trad chick. Have you seen that one?
Mm-mm.
It's like a meme with three of the female Wojaks. It's like a one notch count, and it's just like a normal looking girl. Mm-hmm. A 20 notch count, and it's one that looks like an ethot, and then a 56 notch count, it's a girl dressed up all trad. My energy is amber. Amber is a crystal. Amber is like petrified sap.
All right. I'm at the end of my wits here. So if you guys want to throw some questions at us, I'll be happy to answer these. Give us your wildest shot here.
Ooh, room throughout a research here. The ejaculation and frequency and risk of prostate cancer.
Oh, let's throw that one on there. Okay, there you go. Ejaculation frequency and the risk of prostate cancer. Updated results with an additional decade of follow-up European urology published March 28th of 2016. Is that?
Frequency may be inversely related to the risk of prostate cancer. In other words, semen retention is literally killing you.
Right. Don't do it.
To what level and extent?
I mean, think about it this way. Like, if you don't bust a nut, like, manually, you will eventually do it, like, when you're sleeping, right? I mean, you'll have a nighttime emission, right?
That's a real thing.
Yeah, right, isn't it?
I don't know.
Wet dream, not, I don't know, I never had one.
Yeah, you're asking the wrong guy.
But you have, like, you'll eventually do that. Here's my, so we're at the end of the show here, so I'm just going to throw this out there. I was walking the dogs with my wife this morning, and she's like, so what's the show about today? Are you going to go on with Ryan? I go, yeah. And I go, semen retention. She's like,
she laughed at you too?
I spit out her coffee. You know, yeah. Like, cause she doesn't know anything like this. And I'm like, yeah. And I tried to explain, like, the difference between NOFAP and semen retention and all this other stuff. And she's like,
like you had three heads.
Yeah. Like, it was the funniest thing in the world. And so, but she was like, why would that be a thing? And I go, well, you know, that's, they think that it's some sort of like magical juju, or it's some sort, either that, or it's some sort of like physical thing that, that helps you. She's like, first thing out of her mouth, she goes, wouldn't they get blue balls?
she's a doctor and medicine lady too. So she knows what she's talking about.
In the medical field. Let's just put it that way.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was funny. Oh God, here we go. I love this one. You'll be glad to know that Napoleon Hill has a chapter on sexual transmogrification in Think and Grow Rich. What do you do what you will with that?
Done. I've already done.
Yeah. I don't have, gosh, when it comes to like Phineas Quimby and Norman Vincent Peale and Napoleon Hill, that you're probably talking to the wrong dude.
Yeah.
It's all the same.
That's that secret, thing, man. Think and grow rich. You know what grows you rich? Building wealth.
Yeah.
You don't have to think it.
Oh, yeah. Yes. Clever thinking, intelligence, and hard work. Yeah. You want to know why they're rich? The same reason, actually.
Yeah, this book was...
They figured something out, and you're the sucker that's giving it to them. Yes, Napoleon was also a cult leader. And so was L. Ron Hubbard. So technically is Tony Robbins, and it's never been easier to do these things.
Apple is basically a cult. Tim Cook. Who's the other guy? Steve Jobs. Don't tell me he wasn't exactly the same.
Well, I think he believed in a lot of the same kind of magical thinking.
You have to. That's the thing. And a lot of these guys think, like, when you, this is what you kind of got me on when we were talking about, is it a grift or do they believe it? It is a grift, but it's really hard to lie. People are very good at detecting lies. So the best way to lie is to lie to yourself first. Once you convince yourself, any of one of your tells you give for a lie don't count.
Yep.
So the best grifters actually grifted themselves before they grift you.
Yes, they're pathological liars is what they're. They're much easier to believe if they believe their own bullshit.
Yep.
If they build a world in which they are the president, then it's much easier for other people to go, oh, I guess he's really must be an authority. Really? Because you think about it, you think about the things that people are, we apply respect for, or we believe integrity of people. We think that they're an authority. They have some sort of respectability. Maybe they have some kind of background, whatever. There is also, emotional triggers, there's insecurities and things like that. If you can build a world, a pathological world based on all of the, just the basic human insecurities, you could sell ice to the Eskimos, man.
I would agree. So, what was that? Catch up to a lady in yellow and white gloves.
Which one?
RSD is a failed cult. Oh, where guys will sell ketchup to a lady in white gloves.
Oh no, they're much more successful now. They're way more successful now. You'll notice that they shift. The most successful cults shift from one thing to the next. Mm-hmm. Like they went from pickup to game to positivity in game to just positivity in
that. Well, who was the 1800s? It was an American cult that was about the end of the world coming. And it was like in the 1890s or something like that. Then the end of the world didn't come that year. Mm-hmm. And so they said, oh, thank God, because of our beliefs, it's delayed the inevitable. And then they became more devout because of it.
Mm-hmm.
It was the weirdest thing. I wish I could remember that. I have source amnesia on it, but it was just crazy how that,
well, it sounds like shifted.
Yeah, it was basically like Heaven's Gate, or what are the ones? Doe? Is the Heaven's Gate the one with the meteor?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But I still believe it, as far as I know, the ones that are still alive anyway.
Yeah, let me throw this out there real quick too. Yes, I know Elliot does nofap insofar as he's doesn't jerk off. I'm sure he has sex with his wife.
What is he doing this week? Is it nofap? Is it a Jim Hof breathing method?
Wim Hof.
Jim Whatever.
Jimmy Hoffa's breathing method.
Is it semen retention? Remember that 15 minutes where he was MGTOW? Yeah, Elliot Hulse does a lot of things.
Yeah. Elliot Hulse does whatever's trending.
He used to do powerlifting too, did he not?
Yeah, he's not a bad guy. It's just that he's found his niche.
Yeah, right? Yeah, nobody's a bad guy. Everybody's a wonderful person. It doesn't mean what they're doing isn't garbage.
Yeah. And Wim Hof. Mike Cernovich has been into everything.
What's he on now? Coke and positive vibes.
And I can't finish the show without saying that this was at least in part inspired by an old tweet that was picked up, and I guess it was screen capped because I got it or you got it, and we think we passed it to each other about how he was saying how, what is it? semen retention is retaining your vital essence. And it was like, woo.
Oh yeah. What? And that was, I would say, like, what the f-?
I know. And I was like, is this coming from the, and this was like an old tweet too. I'm like, is this coming from the guy that I know? But, yeah. I mean, be careful, guys, especially when it comes to like superstitions and things you have, like maybe you have an honest emotional, but I believe in God. Okay. Just so you know, but I'm very guarded about like who I am talking to or what, you know, where I take my cues from or anything like that. When you read book four, you'll under, I explained it in the last part of the book. So
That belief makes it very easy to be gullible. Mm-hmm. If you're too open with it,
you have to be very careful with stuff like that. So like when people will play to your convictions, one of the laws of 48 powers. It's learn every man's thumbscrew. Mm-hmm. And it's usually easy to find guys' thumbscrews because it's usually has something to do. Their thumbscrew is right down there. It's right there. Sorry, their dick. You know, that's pretty much where it starts usually.
Well, cons require, what is it? They require gullibility or fear from the mark. They just do. And mm-hmm. if you don't have either, then you're not conable.
Oh, look here. You got a pro, Harry Butthole, who comes in at every end of every show, says, I finished the fuck files. Thanks, Ryan, for a great read. Rolo, drop that new book. Yeah, it's coming.
Oh, Aaron Clary did a 40-minute review of it. I actually managed to watch it today. Mm-hmm. I'm like, dude, the boy hit everything. All the praise was nice, but then he hit all the soft spots that I'm kind of insecure about, too. It was pretty good.
Yep. All right. And I will be remiss in my duties if I ended the show without posting this. We're going to be opening up registration for the Rule Zero Online Conference, which is coming up on the 2nd, October 2nd through the 3rd. That's on 2020. This is sort of our make good thing that we had to do as a result of COVID and all the other crap that's going on in Vegas right now. We felt like we needed to give you something. We got to do something. So we got everybody you see here, all 10 of these speakers will be available over the course of 2 days. Each one of us has at least a 1 hour. If you know me, it's probably going to be more than that. Talk, and we'll have the schedule out right around the time that we open registration. If you already hold a ticket for this event and you were going to go to the one that was in Vegas, then you're already in, so you don't have to do anything. We'll give you your respective tickets or your registration through email. I'm running some special stuff. If you bought a ticket from me, you already know this through my Patreon, that you'll get a 30% discount on the live event that we're going to end up doing in spring if you purchase through me anyways. So that's what I'm doing. Also, we're opening up additional registration. It's going to be September 12th through the 16th. It's only limited to that 1 week window right there. So if you want to be a part of this and be a part of the discussion and everything else, and Ryan, of course, will be there too. So.
Yep, putting up some very special things. I'm like, dude, we're taking people's time and attention. I want to make sure they get their money's worth for it. You know, I constantly blab on about that. It probably drives John nuts. He's stop sounding like one of the pores.
No doubt.
But I will say this too. So like the window's open and I've been saying to this guy since the start, and I think it's important because there's certain people that love to slander us.
Mm-hmm.
For the guys that have already grandfathered into this thing, you're going to be well taken care of. If you decide it's not for you, just send me an email. Cancel it right away, and that leaves outside of the window. Like I have the guys that bought tickets through me. If five guys decide, no, this isn't for me, they get their refund. That's fine. At least that's five spots outside of that window that I can offer to other people in the private community.
Right.
At the end of the day, I want it. It's not about this one thing for any of us. We want to make sure people walk away from this for every dollar they spend with $2 in value. So everybody wins, and that's the whole intention. And I'm sincere as hell over that. I'm not good at marketing, so I'm not griftable.
Maybe I should have done this at the beginning of the show, but like we'll talk about this on Saturday with everybody too on Rule Zero. But I just want to let everybody know that we did this with the best of intention. We started this. We are in no way like conventioneers or anything like that. We just decided that it was just the five guys from Rule Zero back in the day. We're just like, okay, all of us are going to get together in Vegas. We're going to do some things. We have some, it's basically, it was a hangout amongst guys. And we were looking for a place where we could have a speech and like sort of a poolside chat. And that was going to be it.
And then everybody had their extra add-ons on top of it. They're like, yes. And then you sign up, you get this thing ever. I think Rich wanted to take people out fighter jets and I were going to like film a big event with everybody.
Yep. We were going to go do a coffee on the couch kind of thing, weren't we? And film that. And I should say this, Sam Botta, who's actually in moderating the chat right now, he had already reserved a penthouse suite at the top of, I believe it was Planet Hollywood. And we were already ready to go.
And we had the venue booked, the chairs picked out, the linen set.
We had so much. That's what really kills me is like, I really wanted to do it live, but it was just so, you know.
Well, COVID. Vegas
is just a mess right now. They have lost, according to the last estimate, something like $7.2 billion this year because of this.
I know. And it's annoying too, because restrictions were bad enough. We can, like, whatever. If we have to make everybody wear a mask to be compliant, whatever. The problem is now, like Rich and I found out, traveling to the States and then trying to get home, it's impossible for people. Mm-hmm. Like they can't, if I come home, then I have to take a month off of work because they won't let me back into my office for another month. And you're like, yeah, you can't ask somebody to put their life on hold for like more than a week.
Yeah.
I know somebody in Central Florida loves to do that, but we're not in that grift anymore.
Well, and then, like I said, I told all my Patreon people this too. It's like, if you want a full refund, and I've given 8 full refunds already. So if you wanted a refund, that's fine. Most of the guys are like, they're still on board. They want to go to this and they want to go to the live event that we're going to do in 2021, probably like mid spring, I think, of 2021. So we are still planning on doing it. I think the whole appeal of it was having, you know, everybody together in one space. And so we'll still do it, but it can't be when everybody's monkeying around with stupid pandemics and crap like that.
Yeah, if it was just protest in Portland, I would have still had one in Seattle if that was the choice.
Yeah, sorry to say. Yeah, I know, exactly. So, but I think we're going to do a good job with this. So look for that on Saturday. We're doing Rule Zero. It's either me who's hosting. I think it's Rich, actually. Rich is hosting, and then I'm hosting the next one. I'm
throws it off because the summers are so full of him doing whatever it is he does.
Yeah, so look for that. I'm also going to start a mailing list. So if you guys, like a lot of people, the first thing people complain about with respect to Rule Zero is they don't know where the next one's going to be because they didn't watch this show or they didn't watch somebody's show to find out where the next one is. I'm going to start a mailing list so that all I'm going to do is just announce it. Here you go. You know.
Oh, yeah. And all of our newsletters, we're going to combine them together so everybody from all the communities can see it. It's not a bad idea.
So everybody will know when the next Rule Zero is going to be, because we're not going to, people keep asking us, well, why don't you just make it a Patreon or make it a full channel? And I'm like, well, the point was not doing that from the
beginning. Remember what happened last time when we tried to consolidate business plans?
Right.
Well, Frolio to Musi.
But there's always, I want to keep this free. You know, I want this to just be guys coming and hanging out, and it promotes all of our channels for this channel, your channel, everybody else's channel. So
like a host on, when you host it, it's a different channel or a different show than when Rich hosts it or when Troy does. Mm-hmm. Each one's kind of got its own flavor to it, which I kind of enjoy.
I like
it's never a set, like a thing. It's never a cult with like a single way of doing things. It's just kind of very free flowing. I enjoy that.
Casual. I love those too. And then like I'm doing tomorrow, by the way, if you're one of my Patreon subs, I will be doing a Patreon only live stream. I'm going to try to keep it to like an hour to 90 minutes. So
good luck to you on that one, sir.
I know. And it's just going to be questions, because I made the mistake last time of doing a topic and then taking questions. And now I'm going for another like 2.5 hours or 3 hours. So
questions fill it up. My Patreon, we do 2 hours a week, every week.
And then for guys who are hitting me up about counseling, do consider what I'm about to announce will be this weekend. I'm going to do group sessions because that's the only thing I can do until the book is out. If you want one-on-one, I am going to do those, but you're going to have to wait probably until like the last week of September. I'm hoping to get this book out in the wild by the third or the last week of September. So
then we just get to harass Rich about his.
Yeah. Well, you know, I don't know. I want to have it out this year. So that was the plan. And then of course, all this other crap has been going on. So anyways, that's it. Thanks for joining me, Ryan. This has been a lot of fun talking about, here's one. Should every man go through a hoe phase? Yes.
At least you know what the hoe phase is. Actually, I'll end on this because they're actually in my book.
99 answer. Go.
Yeah. If you don't do a hoe phase, once you finally decide to settle down, you're never going to know if she wants you for you or she wants you for stability. The only way to know that is to see a girl who's at her absolute sluttiest. So you know what it looks like. You just need that experience. And I know it sucks for a lot of guys to say you need a hoe phase, but if you can find a better way to do it, I'm all ears. That's the only time tested and true one.
Yeah, I've said this. If you've read my book, you already know what I'm going to say. So spin more plates. It's the only way you can sort of protect yourself against one-itis and soulmate myth crap.
Does she like you for you? Does she like you for your money? Well, I did it when we didn't have money, so I'm pretty sure I solved that one.
Right. And it's the only way you're going to experience the true nature, the real, like live in real time, the nature of women. And then, but don't fall in love. don't get after it. Don't put a baby in her, right? Stay, don't consider monogamy until you hit 30. And then,
mind if I do a quick plug here too when we're done?
Yeah, please do. Please do. I meant to tell you.
So if you guys don't know, I'm going through the sidebar series. Rollo and I and everybody talks a lot about red-pilled stuff, but a lot of people have no idea what it is. They just rant about women online. So I'm literally going through the entire, as close as we can call it, a syllabus. Now we're talking more than just rational male. Rollo's got that, so I'm not doing it. But Athel K, Ian Ironwood, like everybody who's in the sphere and has built it to the place it is. There's 100 different people. And this is right now we're doing Married Man Sex Life Primer, which is probably one of the best books out there when it comes to guys in a relationship thriving after it. We've already finished No More Mr. Nice Guy by Dr. Glover, who is, even though he disagrees about being red-pilled, he's kind of like, I would argue, almost more foundational than Rollo. Same as Manuel Smith with assertiveness training. So do check those out. It's a long-running free series, kills a lot of time, and it's always not during Rollo's ones. So we never interrupt with your red pill content with more red pill content.
You don't get, don't double down.
Exactly.
Double dip.
Right? I don't want people to have to make choices.
All right. I'm losing my voice already. Thanks, man. This has been good. I will see you on Saturday.
See you on Saturday, man.
All right. See you. Thanks, Brian.
Thank you.